I hit record. We're going. Okay. Hurry.
I started late. Okay, I'm
catch up to me.
Wait a second, please. I don't have
this. I'm like running ahead of you in the ad, like the boner pill ad, you know. And it's just like we're frolicking.
Do we have ads now?
Yeah. So welcome to Blink 155, the only podcast hosted by the same dick pills as the Ringer podcasts. Ringer podcast dick pills. You know that they're good because they advertise on the Ringer.
Wait, you just said that the podcast was hosted by the dick pills.
Yeah, it's sentient cool. Dick pills. Listen, that bit was like doomed from the beginning, but I think an exciting new
here's
character.
Here's what I'll say about the bit
it.
That you just did is that I'm gonna be honest with you. I don't really know what the Ringer is, and I feel like every website since Gawker, which I barely understood what it was at the time because I was trying to figure out what Kinja is. I just think that every website is Gawker, and it's like the same five people getting laid off every 2 weeks and then telling everyone to hire
my
again.
Friend.
Yeah, you'd be lucky to have them in your newsroom.
Yeah, a gifted reporter who will tell you all about various cum jars. I know that's Vice, but you know.
I don't know really what the Ringer is, but I have noticed that you have some sort of vendetta against, like, they're your go-to punching bag. And I just want to say, what did the Ringer ever do to you,
Sam? They were rude to the Raptors, who consistently rude to the Raptors, who tonight, the night that this podcast is coming out, are going to show the world what a defending champion truly looks like. The Ringer just never gives them any respect. They're like this, like, vaulted, cool guy sports blog, and they're just a bunch of guys from Philadelphia who suck ass. That makes me mad.
There you have it.
Something about it. You know, like there are those things that grind your gears that I think are funny, and then there's like a handful of things that just like have got under my skin at some point in my life, and they're just
the existence of the sports.
Yeah, the Ringer makes me so fucking angry. Everything. Bill Simmons,
like
everything about
it. Is the Ringer like the NPR to Barstool Sports's like morning radio show? Is that a good equivalent?
No, wait, no.
Like, are they like more highbrow? They're like, oh, we're called the Ringer, and then Barstool Sports is like, ugh.
Yeah, like, I would say they exist like sort of on the arc of sports blogs. There is like Barstool, the Ringer is probably dead in the center, and then you have like the old Deadspin. I guess Deadspin.
Oh yeah,
sort
and
of
they're
back.
Always launching a new one every 2 weeks. Yeah. To those Deadspin people. But they just seem to talk about video games or something, or like they just like do blog posts about like what it means to blog post.
Yeah, and then for some reason like wrestling always, but that's just like the entire internet.
Yeah, everyone's in their wrestling phase. I feel like that's dying down a little bit.
You think it's over? Maybe. You're not getting ready to get into wrestling. It'll be the final pivot for the pod.
I feel like the new thing is just kind of like, you know, ripping off us or ripping off our friends was the kind of the new thing that people do.
Damn.
So that could be the next thing.
I hope
it's
so.
Just, I hope so too. But speaking of sports, I guess, I mean, I wasn't planning any of this intro, but you just started ranting about the Ringer. My God, I'm just chomping at the bit here to talk about this Bill fella and how much you hate him.
Yeah, sorry, I had to get that off. I'm not even that mad about it. It's just like, they always have dick pill ads.
All right, that's fair.
There's nothing wrong
with that. What's wrong with that? What's wrong with dick pills?
There's nothing. Listen, I'm working now on a new character that's a sentient dick pill that hosts a Blink 182 podcast. So
can we get an illustration of that from someone?
Yeah. Looking for some fan art of a sentient dick pill hosting this podcast, please.
I was gonna say that people, you know, people didn't do my challenge to cover a song backwards. I was gonna complain about that, and then I just remembered that. So if you're listening to this, your posse cut verse is due right now.
Mm.
If you don't know what that means, you don't deserve to be a part of it because you're not part of the posse, I think, pretty much. If you're not caught up and you don't know what's going on, then you're not in the posse. It's simple as that. You didn't come up to posse practice.
Yeah.
That's the thing.
It also, it means that like you're kind of up to date because you're listening to this episode, but it means that you
but
maybe...
But not hour three of last week?
Yeah, like you give up halfway through. What do you like not have any follow through? You know, this is why you're never going to make anything of yourself.
Yeah, this is... Exactly. You know who follows through and is thorough with their reportage is the Ringer
podcast. Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Do they? Yeah. Are they good or bad?
Some of their stuff is quite good, actually. That's the problem.
And then all your friends also write for like things called like Blue Jays for Life or something.
Yeah,
or, like,
yeah. Those are the sports blogs I follow.
The Athlete Man. Is that one of them?
Yeah. I love. I'm a supporter of Athlete Man on Patreon.
That's cool.
I need to get all of the Athlete Man content.
Yeah, but basically, I am literally drowning in white guys who have done verses for a Blink 182 podcast offhand joke of a supercut of the Fallen interlude. So
I don't know. I felt like that joke was very on hand.
On hand.
Yeah,
it's true. It was on hand. I had written it on my hand so that I wouldn't forget to make that joke deep into the episode. So, no, that is coming. So if you haven't handed those in yet, please do by the end of today.
This is a
September
reminder.
11th.
If you know, you know.
If you don't know,
the posse
then
rides.
You don't know. You're not in the posse. But other than that, I guess the other thing that we need to talk about off the top is actually kind of a universal thing throughout this whole episode is that it's very much skateboarding season right now, and not just because I'm sheepishly skateboarding at night every couple of weeks when I build up the courage to do so, but I mean, were the Olympics not canceled this year? They would have been in the Olympics for the first time.
Sorry, I thought that was a good question. Were the Olympics not canceled this year? Like, you've just been having such a good time over there that you didn't notice?
I was adopting a sing-song journalism man voice.
Oh, okay. Sorry. I apologize. Yeah. I really interrupted you.
Were the Olympics not canceled? They would have been there.
That's good. You start that again. I like that.
Everyone from Toronto talks like that, including you, when you're listing things. Do that. I know that you haven't written your rap verse yet, so you could kind of do it in that
that's
style.
Maybe like that's because I got to figure out my cadence, right? Because the problem is, and we've experienced this obviously in the Fallen episode, is like it's very easy as a white guy to just do a very, very bad Eminem impression.
Yeah.
And then worse
and
for
it's
me
very
is
hard as
be...
a white guy to be cool and have swag.
One might argue totally impossible, especially when you talk like that. Very hard to have swag.
Anyways, the Olympics were going to have skateboarding this mm-hmm. year. And then I got the new Tony Hawk game this week, and I've been playing that. And I love it. I love playing the Tony Hawk game. It's really fun. Today I tweeted that there's only one song that I have muted on the soundtrack. And within literally 1 minute, someone who knows the band that I was talking about contacted me to confirm that it was that. I didn't think I'd give any context clues, but it was, I guess it's just like everyone has a guilty conscience about the existence of this one song.
I also feel like your tastes are, I don't want to say predictable, but without necessarily knowing what the other songs are on that soundtrack, the idea of you disliking that particular song to me is something that I would have seen. And admittedly, I've spent an inordinate amount of time with you, but
But I guess just by omission, the things I talk about, you can tell what I would hate, maybe.
Yeah, exactly. The thing. Yeah.
But I mean, anyways, that's the whole thing.
I feel like this entire podcast is just like mapping out your mind, really.
It really is. And people are into it, I guess. I'm a specimen.
Other people want to be able to sort of traverse the fertile kingdom that is Josiah Hughes's brain.
So it was either really obvious or there was like a bunch of people who don't even follow me who were DMing me to ask me. I'm just not going to get into that. But
wow, this was like a hot tweet for you.
This week's guest is on the soundtrack Tony Hawk's Pro Skater remake.
The Cure is on the soundtrack?
Yes.
Holy exactly. shit.
But not only that, I think it's one of those things where I think that Blink 155 is once again either influencing or just sort of tapped into the beating heart of pop culture, because I don't even know if you're going to remember this because you don't seem to remember much, but
the Eminem's episode,
We talked about the band Charlie Brown Jr. with the ill-fated singer who I think died of drugs or car crash or something like that. But they're like this, I think, I should probably have looked this up.
Yeah, none of this rings a bell at all.
I think they were, I think they're from Brazil, maybe.
Have you ever heard Charlie Brown Gets a Valentine? I think you'd actually like that band.
Ew, that's a band?
Yeah, but they're like quite sick. A minute. I don't know about that. I'm going to prep. That's fine. Go ahead.
Do you remember, like, there's the acoustic version of Eminem's where they're playing around the campfire and he's like, you and I should get away for
yes,
a while.
Yeah, yes, yes.
That's
yes.
That band, Charlie Brown Jr., the singer died. I had never heard of that band, and they're on the Tony Hawk soundtrack remakes. I think at the epicenter of pop culture. And not only that, of course, we can't get through a week without talking about our dear friend Nate Roos and his.
it's Nate Roos's Blink-155, everyone.
His new skate punk band that he's working on, based on free punk lyrics. And now you're telling me to, you've sent me a recipe from before. We do talk about recipes now. Yeah. Before we start.
Our pre-show banter is pretty spicy. I know a lot of people, want to know what goes on in the chat, and it's Brussels sprout recipes.
I would say this week's pre-show banter was when there's a hot mic on the daily news and you can hear what the hosts are saying. It was that level of banter.
Yeah, that's true.
Like, oh, my spouse loves Brussels sprouts now.
Yeah, it was truly riveting.
And now you sent
stuff.
Me a band. You want me to check out this band while I'm doing a podcast with you?
Well, I'm just hoping I don't know how many links you're going to share with me before the end of it, but maybe when you open this window up to chat with me tomorrow or like 5 minutes after we finish recording the show, you'll think like, oh, I'm not. You're never going to listen to it. I know that.
Maybe I should scroll back 10 kilometers of GChat to see
what else were we talking about last night? Was there a pop punk band that Sam wanted me to listen to like we were 13? The answer is yes.
Nate Roos has started a skate punk band. Mm. The skate punk band utilizes freepunklyrics.tumblr.com, including a guest post from Lord Knows Who. That was the first song that we heard. What's that one called? No Worship. Mm. And now this week, Nate has been so kind. He's checked with his bandmates. He has not, they haven't, I know what the band name probably is. Have I told you? I'm going to tell you right now.
You can tell me in the chat.
It's pretty funny.
Just make sure it doesn't push my links too far back.
Right. And also I should make sure that you can't hear which keys I'm, in my mind, I guess the keys have a different tone.
Oh, like a number. Yeah, like someone forensically is going to, again, map out your entire, oh yeah, that's really good.
It's so funny.
That's really good. But,
it's not. They're not fully on board yet because they're trying to find. They're still working it all out. But we're privy to the creation of this new skate punk band, and so
I love to be privy Nate to things. Isn't being privy to things super sick?
Being privy to things is so good, and I'm so privy to it that I've actually privved up another sample of a new free punk lyric song from Nate Roos.
That's a new tier of priv.
That's a new tier of priv. I got Nate priv. I'm so privved that I was sent the entire song and told what time to do the fade out of the snippet.
Oh, wow.
And then two-time Grammy Award winner Nate Roos checked the snippet and said, that fade out is too abrupt at the end. Can you fix the fade out? And so I did. I mean, I've had to do back and forth today with a Grammy Award winning.
Well, that's the level of perfection that will get you not one but two Grammys.
So this is a political prisoner from the new Nate Roos band. You know the name, Sam, hopefully.
I said it in my mind, yeah. But I hope no one could hear how I said it.
Okay, good. So this is political prisoner. Political prisoner from
holy shit. I just want to say, I mean, the first thing I notice is that that is a perfect fade out.
Thank you. Right.
Just, I mean, it's really good work, Josiah.
It was a little back and forth. I mean, he definitely was right about the first one being too abrupt.
No, that was perfect. The second one,
I think, is really, really good.
Holy shit. Teachers, parents, fucking bosses. Oh, my God. That's good. That's a good hook.
It's so good.
Holy shit.
Just wait until you hear the rest of the song, the outro, which yeah. Anyone who's paying attention knows that. Will he say Naomi Wolf or will he say Naomi Klein? That's kind of one of the will they, won't they's of the song.
Big questions, big exciting creative, unresolved issues within the song. Wow.
So imagine there's a British guy at a restaurant and he's trying to decide what to order and he's having trouble reading the menu, but there's pictures on the menu, and so the waitress comes over and says, do you know what you want? And he's too insecure to try to pronounce it, so he just points at the picture and says, all of this.
So, Josiah, this week, I don't know what I say here. This week, we're talking about...
You've forgotten how to do it?
I can't remember. It's like, what's your opinion of...
Yeah, you always say, what do you think of...
So, Josiah, what do you think about the song I'll Have This by the band...
I'll Learn You.
The Rock's How is the one that sticks with me the most. I think I brought it up in a guest interview recently. Like, it really...
I don't think that one can... And also, The Rock's How, there is an actual geologist in the nation, and he started the account The Rock's How on Instagram, which is like a Blink-155 geology account.
Good.
Now.
It's important. So, I'm glad that we're all going to have an opportunity to really learn something valuable through this. So, this week, we're talking about...
You don't ever say this week.
I mean, do I not?
It's weird. You're like, it's almost like you've forgotten how to do it, but you're being even more professional than usual.
I think I told you this has been a long week, and so my brain is just like totally misfiring. I've had calls. I've called people the wrong name on calls. Like, I think I'm just having a series of tiny strokes. Like, I'm just really struggling. And so,
well, Sam, if you have a series of tiny strokes, eventually you will come. So,
oh wow, that was great. Going. That was really good, man. How do you think you feel about the song?
All of this. How do I think? That's a better question because I don't know how I feel.
How do you think that you feel about this? Yeah.
How do I think that I feel about this song?
That's what I want to know.
What is that even?
Wait, yeah, wrap your head around that and try to answer me, please. Save me.
Myself. I feel pretty confused because I think. I know that I used to make fun of this song a lot when I'd get to it on the album. Mm. Now that I listen to it today and think about how it sounds like Jason Segel's Dracula musical from the Forgetting Sarah Marshall,
which is a great musical, yeah.
It's such a good musical. And it led him to put at least one good movie into the Muppet canon, which no one's been able to do. So, I mean... That's important that I'm thinking of that.
So it holds an important place in pop culture history.
I think it's like weird and dumb that it's just like the outro guitar of Easy Target that's been looped and turned into another song. But I also think it's kind of cool for that reason. It's also really long. I don't even think I listened to it all the way through when I was getting ready to talk to you because it's so fucking long. But it's kind of cool still.
Yeah. So
I don't know.
I feel like this is a... If not a top five song for me, this is like a top 10 Blink song for me. And quite possibly the best Cure song.
Really?
I mean, I don't really think that's like truly stupid, but I never was, we've talked about the Cure a lot, especially because like Mark talks about the Cure a lot and thinks that this band sounds like the Cure, which they don't, except for this song. But I never like really properly appreciated The Cure, I think, until I like got older. Like, I don't think I really got into The Cure until like the pandemic, and then it's just like, I just had more time to like really listen to albums and I got very into Disintegration. And I think also when I was younger, when people like discover bands like The Cure and The Smiths, I was like not actually sad enough for this kind of music. Like I was superficially sad, so Dashboard worked.
Right, you were like fake sad.
Yeah, whereas like The Cure I think is for, I mean also just for like, you know, gothy, weepy teens, but I think also like maybe more truly sad music. And now that I'm old and I know sadness, I'm down with it. But I have listened to this song. This has been on so many mix CDs that I made when this record came out. Like this song goes on playlists for me like today. I listen to this song a fucking lot. I think it's really good.
Huh.
Yeah, top 10. I would say top, like, I'll strip away the top five joke for the sake of, like, making the point, top 10 song.
And because also around the time of the Damned episode, we're going to be doing our, I don't know if we've announced this yet, we're going to do our real top fives.
It's going to be brutal.
I'm already thinking about it all the time. I'm already having some hot takes in my brain.
I'm having intrusive thoughts about it. This is really, it's causing me to, so, you know, forget how to introduce episodes, use the wrong name.
That's kind of an amazing level of poserdom because I was worried that people were going to get mad at me for just saying, I only kind of know The Cure's hits and I never really got too deep into them. And I used to actually really love this Ben Folds cover of a Cure song and it like
got me
to check out The Cure more.
In Between Days, but, right? On the like one, he did those like three EPs.
Yeah. Oh, it's so good.
That cover is fucking great. There was covers on all, there was that, there was Get Your Hands Off My Woman, which is like a fucking great cover.
Oh, no. That gives me so much embarrassment.
No, it's good, though, because he's like, he can do listening the campy to that, shit.
I listened to that on a road trip down the West Coast with my high school friend Nathan. At least a couple of listeners out here know who Nathan is. He was a member of FOMO 100 for a bit. And we just one time decided, like, we had just graduated high school and we're just like, fuck it, we're just going to drive to California tomorrow. And so we like went on this impromptu road trip and we had a mouse that lived, we bought a mouse and it lived in our car. And we like ran out of money. And so we stole bottles and cans from a bottle drive at a school to pay for gas.
I'm sorry, wait, you bought a mouse?
Yeah, we got a mouse from like a pet store. I think it was a feeder mouse for like snakes, but it lived in our car.
Like just we got did it have free reign in the car? Did you also get like a cage?
It was in the glove compartment mostly.
Oh, are you fucking kidding me? And then what did you do when the mouse inevitably died like 2 days later or whatever?
We left it in an ATM receipt thing in Concord, California. We're just really shitty people.
Like the dead mouse, or you left it alive?
Yeah, the dead. No. Like we fed it. We tried to keep it alive. We gave it water. We like took care of it.
How long did it last?
I mean, time is kind of confusing of this trip because I feel like it was about a month long road trip, but I think it was maybe like 5 days.
Did you name the mouse?
We did, but I can't remember its name.
Oh, fuck.
But this was like, this was like, anyways, I just think of listening to that Ben Folds EP in the car.
Yeah, it has Wandering on it, too. I don't know which of those three EPs has that, but like, that's one of the best Ben Folds songs.
We only had that CD, like one CD, and then an Exposures in the Sky one. And we slept in the back of the station wagon in like Safeway parking lots. It was really, really charming and really embarrassing time. Really funny.
I love but that. What's embarrassing about that?
Just like, I guess that we stole bottles and cans from an elementary school to pay for gas.
That's it's young people shit.
Yeah, true. But that makes me think of The Cure. Other than that, I was going to say, like, I never really got that deep into them, so I thought I was going to be the one being a poser. But I feel like saying that you love The Cure because you got into them within the last 6 months is like a next level pose.
Yeah.
That is so brazen that I respect
it. I just mean I really love that record.
You're the alpha poser.
Yeah, but I'm not pretending that it's like I've got multiple like Robert Smith tattoos. Like same thing. I mean, I love the hits. And I like probably listened to the Greatest Hits collection a bunch on, you know, whatever, Ardio back in the day. But, it was just never...
Rest in peace.
Yeah, I know. Truly, like, the only good streaming service that there ever was.
Probably just because it wasn't around long enough for everyone to hate the shit out of it.
I think that's it, yeah. No, it had, like, the best interface, you know?
But isn't it just... It's interesting because The Cure is... Like, there's so many albums and there's so much content.
That's it. I think it's like there's too fucking much.
The other thing that's funny is just today, this is also kind of like the us, Charlie Brown Jr., us being at the center of the universe, we had already planned this episode. I already done the guest spot. And then Robert Smith just today was talking about how he's almost done the new Cure album and he appeared on a fucking Gorillaz song.
Yeah, so, yeah. No, I saw that quote. I was like, timely. But
yeah.
That's the thing is, I think like this band also, because they had such an outsized influence on a lot of the bands that we got into early, like there were a lot of people that did Cure covers, you know, like, I love Close to Me and I love the Cure version, but I love it because the Get Up Kids covered it. I think Goldfinger covered Just Like Heaven, maybe. And I was like, this is sick. And so like, I love Just Like Heaven, but I love all the fucking, you know, basic songs that everybody likes.
Yeah, I mean, they're incredible songs.
Yeah, they're like real. But I guess the thing is like what I'm saying is I'm very late to it, but I'm finally like, oh, these album cuts are actually quite sick also.
Right. Like, I get it. And thankfully, we do have a Cure expert, like lifelong, on the pod this week too, who similarly says that this does sound like what he said was like bad later Cure. Sounds like this song. So it is kind of cool, though, that they didn't try to fit him into a Blink song, but they like made a Cure song with him, kind of.
It's so strange because like, yeah, maybe it does sound like bad later Cure. That's the other thing is like, do you remember, like, I feel like when I started to get into like new music, you know, like listen to the Thursday 30 on the Edge all the time. And it was like right around the time that the Cure put out Wrong Number, which today I actually think is like kind of a fun song, but I don't think is really considered to be like top tier Cure material.
Right.
And so they always just sort of seemed like, eh, like that was, I feel like one of the earliest Cure songs I heard was Wrong Number as like a new song from this like legendary band. And you're like, is this a legend? Really? This is it, huh? You know, and those things like really shape your opinion of these like artists when you don't have like the internet, you know?
Yeah, totally. I know. And I guess that's the thing, too, is like even around this time, you would have known I Miss You or Feeling This if you're a casual fan. But this is pretty sick as an album cut.
That's the thing is like, these are the songs, and I know I've referenced this, like when you get into like any new Feldman material and you're like, where is this? Like, this is so, because I don't really think, and maybe like someone who is properly intimately versed in the music of the Cure can say this, like, it doesn't sound 100% like them just trying to write a Cure song. Like, this feels like it is of a piece with I Miss You, where it's like a super kind of Blink melody, like recognizable in its kind of like fundamentals and its DNA, but just like totally reimagined in this like really interesting way. You know, in a way that like last week's kind of like, oh, let's sample and sort of like remix. And I mean that like not in the bad way, but in like, you know, the equally stupid way, I guess. Like, let's remix the sort of fundamentals of some element of this band and like try to do something new and interesting. And like the Fallen Interlude is an example of that going fucking terribly. But like, yeah. This and I Miss You are examples of like that risk paying off. And I think it's just like so distressing. You know, this morning I was out for a run and what's the fucking disaster? Like one of
That's from
Dogs Eating Dogs. Where that came on and I was like, man, this song's so fucking good, because they were like at least trying to do a thing, right? And I just like that just evaporated. Like I actually find it so depressing to think.
It's almost like they're not. They are doing a thing, but it's almost like they're not trying. They're just kind of being more authentically themselves rather than actually trying. Like it almost feels effortless on this album or on Blink songs with Tom, where they stumble upon some kind of new ideas because they just were like, yeah, we love The Cure and we were just fucking around in the studio and then we looped this thing.
Yeah.
And then he came in and did his sad Dracula song and it ended up magical. Like, that's pretty sick.
Yeah, it is. And that's the thing is it feels like, you know, just the logical endpoint of a band that was like getting sick of what they were doing, but has constantly, like, again, I think what sucks about some, or what resonates in a bit of a hollow way in this era, is this idea that like they think they discovered Fugazi. Like, we've talked a lot about that before. Right. But the flip side of that is that I think they've literally always talked about being Cure fans, or like Mark in particular has always talked about being Cure fans. And so when they try to like take what Blink does and like put it more squarely in that mold, where it's not just about like how you're approaching like writing melodies or whatever, like writing good pop songs, I think you get something really interesting because like there's a fundamental understanding of what it is. Like Mark loves The Cure. He knows what actually makes a good Cure song, right? Whereas like I don't know that the band really like understood what made a good Fugazi song like all the time, you know?
Right.
I don't know what makes a good Fugazi song.
I think as I get older, I realize there aren't as many good Fugazi songs
as like you maybe thought. Yeah.
I kind of think, you know, there's something about it that when I'm looking at the Genius page, I'm looking at a quote from Robert Smith about the collaboration, and something about it like kind of reminds me of, because to me at least, The Cure, even though Mark loves them and stuff, they are such a like highbrow band compared to Blink-182. Mm-hmm. And they're so like serious and kind of like a respected band, and even just like the kind of gothiness of it, it doesn't really fit with Blink-182. But I kind of almost feel like this collaboration is maybe like the roots of what we do sometimes, where we have people that you would never expect to come talk about Blink-182, and then something special happens, like Edward Hirsch or whatever coming on to talk about it. Like it kind of, the quote from, so Robert Smith said this to Spin, and it just made me think of the pod kind of. He said, "I got a message saying Blink-182 wants to talk to you about doing something on their new album. I went to my teen nephews and nieces and asked, what do you think it would be like if I sang with Blink? And they told me that would be so fucking cool. So I borrowed some albums of them and I started listening to them, and I actually thought they had some really, really good songs. I thought some of it was awful and some of the songs were really sort of crass. I can't explain to you in what context I listened to those albums because it was too personal. It was like a family tragedy. The whole family was together, and to kind of alleviate the atmosphere, one of my nieces put on a Blink album and it really kind of did the trick. I was listening to it because I was still feeling pretty miserable, and I thought, they're actually really good." I mean, that's just, there's something in there that reminds me of the pod, kind of.
Yeah. That's like, yeah, it's sort of like a lovely sentiment, right? Of like, yeah, I hate this. Like, also just the idea of being like, okay, this part is stupid. This part I do not care for, but like fundamentally, oh, fuck, this is great. And also like the idea of it being this sort of, Blink as like an atom that connects everything, you know, in our lives, in this world, like the shocking number of unexpected connections that we've been able to find through like 18 years of doing this podcast.
Exactly. Yeah. And even just like him saying that he was in the middle of a family tragedy and it was just like life was agony, but then somehow this band, like it was good to him. It's just like, it's so strange. Like everything about this quote is so familiar to me,
totally.
Even though I had never read it until today.
Well, it's also the idea of like, you know, I mean, we've talked about this, like there's been, through the duration of doing this podcast, there has been like ups and downs in our lives on pod and off pod. Like the beginning of the pandemic was like very, you know, I mean, it still fucking sucks ass. And like we did the Twitch stream, and like that was, I think, like very important to my mental health, and I'm sure like maybe some other people. And like, you know, it's cool to think of like how talking about and listening to Blink can be like a healing experience.
I know. It's
like, but like legit, right?
Yeah, like I still just don't fully get it. But I think because when like Green Day tries to go highbrow, they're too trying to be highbrow to begin with, that they can't really. It's something about the yin and yang of Tom and Mark's dick jokes, mm-hmm. and like being fucking idiots that fits so well with highbrowness that doesn't really work with very many other things, if anything.
But I also think like Green Day's version of highbrow, and like, look, I mean, no real disrespect here, because obviously, you know, Billy Joe, Green Day, love you boys. But they tried to like be the Beatles, you know, like when Green Day fully fucking lost the plot after American Idiot, it was like, I am John Lennon, you know? Whereas I think deciding that you're going to really try to channel like just like a very gothy Englishman is like not necessarily that you've reached those heights. Like this isn't as good as like the best Cure song, but, if your version of highbrow is on some level more authentic to who you are, again, I think it's like you're more easily able to sort of stretch your abilities into like a new space.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's true. And also maybe there's something to be said about like, not that not that Blink was ever into hardcore, but, you know, they were into skateboarding. Mm-hmm. And there's like there's a track that all these people take that kind of like lends itself to, sure, being a poser in some ways, but also being authentic in other ways, that is kind of different than Green Day. Like the end result for Green Day is that they're going to make some of those like awful Elvis Costello adult contemporary coffee shop albums one day.
Yeah.
You know, it's like Green Day doing it.
This is all headed for Billy Joe's Nora spectacle, Jones. You know?
Yeah, exactly. It's just like totally the opposite of Blink is at least rooted in like some sort of underground kid street culture of some kind, which is still hilarious to say, but maybe that's why. Either way, there's just something, I guess there's just something uncanny about this collaboration, and there's something uncanny about Phil Elverum like reacting to I Miss You after writing all these devastating, heartbreaking songs over the years. And, you know, there's just something like uncanny about this that doesn't exist elsewhere. And I think there's something in the music that makes it like that too.
I also think like this is going to be so, I don't know how else to say this. This sucks. But like, I think if you are, fuck man, forgive me for this. Okay. We're going to have to edit this out. Like if you are like a real authentic musician, you know, like a fucking artist, I hate the way this is coming out of my mouth, but you know, if what you are dedicated to is like that craft and the notion of like the authenticity of expression, and not even like somewhere deep inside you that you've buried, you know, like focused on external elements, focused on aesthetics, like focused on what the music that you make or you listen to communicates about you, which I would argue is probably people like Phil Elverum and probably people like Robert Smith, that like you are then capable of like peeling back the layers of like, you know, shit, piss, fuck, artifice in Blink-182 and like recognizing in a song like I Miss You, like a similarly, like coming from a very different emotional place, coming from a very different place of just like life experience, but like the same like authenticity of expression. And I think that that is ultimately also what is really present in this song.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, to be clear, Phil really hated I Miss You, and I think I do too. I can't remember how I feel about I Miss You, but I'm pretty sure I'd be fine without it. But I think you're right. There's something, yeah, like it's interesting too, because it's not the kind of thing where it's like, yeah, my label was like, Robert, you have to do this. And it was like he listened to okay, here we go. It's like he listened to Blink and then he said, "I'll have this."
No.
But you know, he did the homework, and he decided to like come at it from a place of like making sure he understood the band before he committed to it. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't just like, because you can kind of tell when some old guy who's like kind of confused was just pushed into a room with a young band that likes him. And this doesn't sound like that at all. It does sound like an equal collaboration.
Yeah, and again, it also just like fundamentally works, right? Because they're not jamming Robert Smith into a Blink song. It doesn't sound like they're trying to rip off a Cure song. Like it ultimately does sound like they've all met in the middle, and in the same way that like Mark and Tom, when they do like take advantage of the opportunities that the interplay between their voices provide, is like, it's so fucking great. Like as a combination, like Robert Smith occupies just like an even more melodramatic version of, I think, like Mark's lower register. And so yeah. Like also like you're two guys who are like so easy to impersonate as vocalists, right? Like these are two very extreme styles of singing that like I think completely fucking work together and complement each other like really, really effectively, as much as like the best Tom Mark trade-off.
Totally. Yeah, I know. And that's the thing, is like I also think it took me a long time, but I still sometimes go back to Random Access Memories by Daft Punk, but there's like there's that one song that sounds like a vampire is singing on it in there too, and I'm just like, I kind of think we need more vampire vocalists out there who sound kind of like the Count, you know?
That's interesting. I'm into it. Because I think like that version of the vampire has like obviously like, you know, fallen out of fashion.
Yeah, they're more sexy now. Or like maybe this sounds like the Phantom of the Opera voice too. I've never seen that, but I know that this will get you excited if I say that title.
Yeah, like a little bit for sure. But I think the thing is, like, you know, Phantom is just still very, like, pretty much straight music theater. I think, like, when you're, like, in your, like, vampiric, you know, new wave band, there's way more opportunities to, like, flex that, like, you know, really spooky vibrato. Yeah.
It's so good.
And that's the thing is, like, also Phantom, like, musicals, like, for the most part, like, there's obviously, like, emotional cadence and yada, yada, yada. But for the most part, it's, like, very, very precise, crystal clear singing. And, like, Robert Smith is, like, not, like, it's very much, like, you know, again, this sort of, like, emotional cadence, you know.
Right. I guess one thing that does suck about it is that it's about Holly. And no disrespect to our friend, listener of the show, fan of the show from the nation, Holly, who has proudly declared herself Holly from the song, I think in an effort to get on this episode. but you do get a mention here. Shout out to you, Holly.
Yeah, so it worked out a little bit.
But I don't think that it's about you. I think it's about Jerry Finn's crush from grade school who soaked him with a hose. Remember? That was Target was about too. And then I guess he was so upset by the hose thing that they decided that their one opportunity with Robert Smith that they would bring up the hose thing again.
It's so good. Do you think Holly knows? Like, do you think she's like, it wasn't even like that. He doesn't remember it right.
Yeah, he's gaslighting her.
Yeah.
Well, now he's no longer alive. So, I mean, she's stuck. Is his word against hers?
No opportunity for reconciliation.
You ever, like, when you were a kid, did you think that, like, having a garden hose would be a bigger part of your adult life? Because I kind of did.
Yeah, just assume like, that's when I'd know I was an adult. And that's also how I know that I'm not.
Yeah, exactly. But we did live in a house in Calgary for a while, and we did have, like, plants, and there was a hose, but I don't know. The landlord was like, so you guys are into gardening, right? Like, I want someone to maintain the garden. And I was like, yes, we are. And then, I don't know, it's too confusing. I don't want to use a hose.
My landlord...
I feel like I'll either water over or under hose it all.
My landlord, like, lives below us, and when he's away, I'll water his plants. And so there is a garden hose out front of our house. And I like, it's the best feeling in the world. Just like sitting there, just like, psh, and it's the most, I feel like I'm getting to play as an adult, you know? Just sitting out here, just spraying little like planter boxes, you know?
So the lyrics are, with all of this I know now, everything inside of my head, it all just goes to show how nothing I know changes me at all. That's, those lyrics are too good to be in a Blink song.
Yeah, do you think Robert Smith wrote his verses?
He must have. I mean, that's also funny to think. Like, he has, like, a BlackBerry, and he's, like, a rapper in the booth.
Yeah, just like, no, okay, I'm ready to go, put me in, yeah.
Or, like, what's that lie they used to say about Jay-Z that he just, like, made everything up as he went along?
Yeah, it was all off the dome. Is that not true?
Just provide, I don't know. I feel like he had, like, a small writer's room punching it up. Like, Jeez. Come on. There's no way.
Raps off top of head.
Again, I wait for this to change instead to tear the world in two. Another night with her, but I'm always wanting you. Use me, Holly. Come on and use me. We know where we go. Use me, Holly. Come on and use me. We go where we know. I mean, maybe they've just made Holly into a character.
That's sort of how I
interpret it. Doesn't seem like it's about a garden hose anymore.
No, I feel like it's just like, you know.
This is more about the existential aftermath of being hosed down as a boy.
I also think like this is their attempt at like a highfalutin artistic record, and a major component of those is like obviously they don't pretend that this is a concept record, but so many bands do. They're like, this is actually a concept record, and you're like, okay, you've just used the same like, you know, proper noun four times and said there's a plot and like whatever. And so I think the idea of trying to create like a Blink-182 cinematic universe that Holly is the, you know, the only recognizable character within, to me it just seems right. Like an attempt to create cohesion.
It's true. That is true. Because I guess the riff is recycled. Mm-hmm. And so they're like, well, that riff represents baby Jerry being hosed down in the driveway. and the trauma of that, the trauma of that hose. Which, if anything, it was probably a hot summer day, Jerry. Probably felt nice.
Yeah, Southern California.
You know, reading like, Mommy's Little Monster.
Yeah. So gross. But I just mean, like, it gets hot down there. Like, she like, maybe in her version of it, she was like, he was soaking wet with sweat. You know, I was being coy. Yeah, but I thought he'd appreciate it. Not the case, Holly. I'm sorry to say you've been memorialized in song as a dick.
Poor Holly. Where's Holly? If anyone knows Holly, let's get her on the horn.
Yeah.
We need to hear Holly's side about the hose. But these lyrics are really good. You're right. She's all I need. She's all I dream. She's all I'm always wanting. And then, oh, again, I wait for this to fill the hole, to shake the sky into another night with her. I'm always wanting you. Imagine, like, yeah, you get him on the show, on your song, on the show. I'm still thinking of how this is Blink-155.
Yeah.
But you get him on, and then he doesn't just, like, do it because he has to. Like, you know, some of the big guests we've had maybe were like that. Mm. But instead, he's, like, fully embraces it 100% and does it and then writes these sick lyrics. Like, this is what it said. So here's another quote from, I guess, the liner notes or somewhere. It says, Blink-182 was concerned that he might not want to collaborate because of their earlier music. And he said, nobody knows what kind of songs you are going to write in the future, and nobody knows the full potential of any band. I really like the music you sent me.
Wow.
It's so good.
What a something wise about man. This whole
it's like, this is like making me like a little bit emotional to read. It's so powerful. It's so cool to think that like they had this person that they looked up to so much, and then that person came into their world and like respected it and took it seriously, and then like they created something that is maybe not bigger than both of them, but like just something that's special.
Yeah, I love that. Like the idea that's of so someone you admire also being like so fundamentally, like, being as good as you could hope so that person could be. You know what I mean? Because you hear this all the time. Like, you know, I mean, this I've. You know, I'm not bringing this up on purpose, but I think it was like an interesting part of the conversation that you had with Nate when he was on the pod, you know, about like, you know, perceptions of him or perceptions of fun at the kind of peak and being like bummed out when people whose music you appreciated kind of like wrote you off. Right. And
right.
And so it's just so great to think that like you could have a guy like Robert Smith and probably say to them like, some of these songs fucking suck shit, boys. You know, right. I don't care for your potty humor.
But I won't have that.
Yeah,
but I will have.
Yeah, and I just think like that is such a like lovely, like what a lovely moment to have with someone that you've clearly grown up idolizing. Like it is, yeah. It's like just wonderful.
It's so nice. Yeah, it's so cool. Well, yeah, I guess I think I really do love this song. You win.
Thanks, man.
But something else I noticed here, and I fact checked it quickly to make sure that it's real. And it is real. It's from some sort of clickbait thing where he was talking about what's on his iPod. But the band went on hiatus and broke up, obviously. And if they hadn't of, this was going to be the fourth single. And the music video was going to be directed by M. Night Shyamalan. Could you imagine? This is the quote from him. I love this song. Almost did a video for this. It would have been about vampires.
Yes. That's why he's the guy. Ah, oh, fuck. Can you imagine? That's heartbreaking.
Does the Dracula song like actually sound like this? I'm just gonna see.
What do you mean
the Jason Segel one?
Oh yeah, let's.
No, he'll kill you.
Oh, this is it.
This movie is good.
What's
Mila Kunis
up to these days?
But I have a surprise for you.
What's Jason Segel up to these days?
Well, Family Guy still.
Okay.
Jason Segel tried to be dramatic. Remember?
Oh right, he did Infinite Jest. Right? No, he did.
Peter Bretter. He did play the end of the tour in a movie.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, and then he did like a Netflix one that no one watched called something. I can't remember.
Oh, this
whoa,
is
a- his name is Peter in this and he's with Mila Kunis. That's weird.
Peter.
Yeah, it's like, what is, okay, Mila Kunis, give me the update on her real quick then.
Well, her and Ashton, I mean, thank Ashton's you. Killing it in the investment banking realm, so she's,
you know, I
she doesn't need
else,
to work.
Context,
are they,
but of course, Bad Moms is, Yeah, I think so. Bad Moms is a...
Oh, yeah, those movies are big.
They're huge. She's crushing it.
Okay, so this is the vampire song. This is the Dracula song.
Let's see if... I'm really hoping this will sound like The Cure.
It's getting kind of hard to believe things are going to get better.
Yeah, it does.
It definitely sounds like all of this.
I've been drowning too long to believe that the tide's going to turn.
It's so good.
This is a good movie.
I've been living too hard to believe things are going to get easier now. I'm still trying to shake off.
What a cutie that guy is.
He's the best.
And if I see Van Helsing...
Okay, well, Robert Smith probably wouldn't go there, but,
okay, yeah.
You know. It's close.
Oh, wow. Okay. Well, that's, yeah, you're right. That's basically this song. But this came after it, right?
They did sort of this relationship, much like Nate Roos and Blink-155, it did blossom in multiple ways, and they did do a lot of cross-promo. Blink-182 covered a couple of Cure songs, which we'll check out in a second. But here's something. Blink-182 interview MTV icon The Cure. I don't know what the title is, but...
The Cure was probably my favorite band for a long time.
I just sit in my room and just play the tapes over and
oh yeah, this is the special tapes, right, where everyone covers the Cure.
Figure out the lyrics and just write them out on paper just to do it. And that's actually what influenced me to start writing lyrics in the first place. I mean,
Boys Don't Cry was the first one that I heard, and I loved it, and then wanted to find out more and more about this band.
Boys Don't Cry is absolutely one of my favorite albums ever made, you know, in terms of just an album.
Who's this lad?
I have a Cure tattoo. It's like one of the only band tattoos I have.
But really, I really, really, really mean that.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe he's in McFly or something?
Yeah, or McBusted.
Also, like, it's great because Blink looks so gothy in this. Like, I don't know that I've ever seen him look this, like... gothed up outside of the I Miss You video. Like, it's fully... They're doing a lot.
Mr. Smith, a lot of bands, including ourselves...
Yeah, Mark's outfit is insane.
...a major influence on their songwriting and their career.
Everyone's hair is dyed jet black. To know
how you feel about that.
Robert, we're all wondering...
Are they asking
band,
questions?
What possessed you to say yes when we asked you to collaborate on a song on our new record? Why would you want to say yes to that?
Yeah, it is true. And when you cut to this, it is truly a question.
It was funny, actually, because it was quite divisive when they phoned up and I told the others and people around me whose opinion I trusted. It really did kind of, like, make people jump one side or the other and say, no, you know, you don't want to do that. Other people saying, yeah, like when I played them the songs, most people actually changed their mind when I played them the demos. I realised that Blink kind of, you know, had the kind of seen in a certain way, but they were trying to evolve and have evolved into something more. And I think what they've done is, I think their album is a great album. I think they are a great band. So I had no hesitation myself, actually, in joining in with them. I was very flattered to be asked, actually.
What a cutie!
What a sweet guy!
And now he's doing songs with fucking gorillas. Give me a break.
There's a couple of good gorillas jams. The first one.
Give me Prozac instead. Oh, way better.
The truly, yeah, God tier cartoon band.
This is from the same special. MTV, it's Blink icons. Covering A Letter to Elise. I think this is really bad. I've seen this before.
The original Antichrist superstar.
Oh yeah, Marilyn Manson sang Blink-182 is worth it alone in this clip.
Wait, Marilyn Manson, oh, he sings
Blink-182. Making music that means so much to me.
That would be cool.
You know Marilyn Manson was on Clone High, by the way.
Ooh. And also he was on The Wonder Years.
Heavier than what I already knew, but was something extra. Romance for the ladies. But still heavy and clever too. Here's Blink-182 with A Letter to Elise.
I wish like MTV TV kind of stuff. I'm not trying to be like the person who says I wish they still played music, but I wish they at least were like trying to be edgy still.
Yeah.
Like, so you just kind of miss that instead of having like Ryan Seacrest or whatever.
Yeah. I mean, the idea of having Marilyn Manson in like a swing and a...
Exactly.
The Halloween set be like, and now Blink-182. Like, you're like, man, the 2000s were good.
TV used to be so good.
I mean, I was thinking about that because I recently watched the episode of Hot Ones that Dan Levy was on, and they kind of referenced some of the stuff that he did when he was on MTV Canada. Because it is like, it's always the cuts to the person like smiling through it that are weird here. But you know, like watching like an American host kind of talk about the shit that like Dan Levy and Jesse Cruikshank and like those early MTV Canada hosts like did on television, like, God, that was so fucking funny, and some of it was really fucked up, and like none of that happens on like youth television.
No.
Anymore. I mean, it happens online. Like, I'm not saying it doesn't happen, but it's like none of those companies.
But even like things like YouTube that they're all watching now, it still seems so like squeaky clean and calculated. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't
know.
Also,
I've got to say, we've talked over this.
Really old.
We've talked over this entire cover, but I do want to say it actually sounds a lot better than I remember.
This is pretty good, man.
Man, Blink should have never gotten back together after this.
If this was the end of this band, can you fucking imagine? You'd be sitting here being like, what could they have done? Like, they were just finally, like, finding their thing.
Exactly.
It sucks. It's actually fucking, now I'm fucking bummed out, man.
It's an emotional time. We're coming to the end of the pod. Everything is becoming clear what the pod means, what the band means. We figured it out.
What we mean to each other.
Exactly. Yeah,
this is good.
Korn is on this special too, and like this whole set looks like a Korn video.
Yeah, it's like one of those things where like this is not the Cure's version of gothy. This is like very much like a new metal version of goth.
Yeah. This is really good cover.
This is fucking awesome.
Travis was so good at like being really busy without sucking up all the oxygen in the room back then too.
Yeah, it's true. Also, sorry, it took me a second, but I was like, this sounds exactly like the way that they're playing it. This sounds exactly like a Blink song, and they basically just after this turned this into Snake Charm.
Oh yeah,
like it's literally
totally.
Like it's the same fucking song.
Yeah, you're right. Good girls, they like to sing.
But there's especially like, bam, 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 bam. Like, that's how they're playing. It's the fucking same. Like, they definitely figured out this cover, and then we're like, man, can we just, like, have that as our own song? And then wrote Snake Charmer.
Deftones and Razorlight pay their tribute to Cure, the masters of the cheerful nightmare, after these special messages.
Do you think Marilyn Manson liked the Blink cover?
Yeah, but Marilyn Manson seems cool.
This will be much worse. This is from 2018, and it's them covering Just Like Heaven at a weenie roast.
Now I just want to watch the rest of that special, though. I was like, you have to show me the Korn and Deftones covers.
I know, we don't have time.
So this is sorry, from a weenie roast?
Yeah, this is with Skiba. I feel like Matt Skiba needs like to practice guitar more always. Even though he's always hitting everything right, it just feels like he should practice more. Shit, this is kind of good too.
Also, when they were showing Travis earlier, he was like really grinning. He was very sweet.
Now he, in this video?
Yeah.
Oh, I was like, he's something about the way these weenie roast videos are shot. He looks so sweaty though. I thought it's like. He's like struggling.
Just a wet, smiling boy. Yeah, this is great, man. Like, if you
what
went and
hell?
Saw Blink and they did this, you'd be like, fuck yeah.
Yeah, it actually sounds like, man, maybe the Cure influence is what's missing in modern Blink.
I mean,
because this kind of sounds like Cheshire Cat.
Yeah,
or something.
Yeah, totally. Dude, you're totally right. Because if you think about, like, all the good Dude Ranch songs also kind of have this, you know what I mean? Like, Apple Shampoo, yeah. Waggy, like, they're all this.
We don't even need to do any more episodes after this one. We should stop.
This is the last episode of the pod.
It all makes so much sense.
Fuck off. Yeah. Like, this is like, it's never over till it's done. Like,
exactly.
It's all the good songs.
But instead they're always doing, like, when they go fast, they do, like, a Bad Religion chord progression.
Yeah.
Who I do like in the context of Tony Hawk. They have the most pirate shanty song imaginable.
So, are there new songs,
like,
or is it
like
still
a
just...
rock, like a mountain, like a fucking atom bomb.
I live on mountain by the joy and the sadness that I encounter everywhere I turn. I've known it all along. In the books and magazines. Man, me and one of the ways that, like, Zorgel and I used to, like, bond, like, Aaron, like, in junior battles, we would just, like, get, obviously, like, you know, blotto at the bar, and then at, like, 2 in the morning be like, okay, I think I have a Mickey back in my house. And then we just go back to our houses and, like, find guitars and, like, just literally, like, sing You by Bad Religion, like full harmony the whole time. And I was like, this is the most magical experience of my life. Like, I was just like, I meant to sing with this person. This is so lovely.
I just think it's better to try to sound like a Dracula musical than it is to sound like a pirate chain.
Yeah, look at, like,
why
for
I
Blink,
think
yeah.
Blink, if they're missing that, they need to go back to whatever that was.
Yeah.
Wow.
That was also this much better than the Goldfinger cover of Just Like Heaven, I should add.
Oh man, Goldfinger's so good too on the soundtrack. Good lord.
Is it just here in your bedroom, or is it Superman? What's on the soundtrack?
It's Superman. Yeah. Superman. Okay. Here's them playing it with Robert Smith, I think. Probably around the time.
Ooh, nice and fast.
Yes. They played it Nightcore live.
Yeah. This is so fucking good, man. How do you not love this song?
I do love it. I just, like, my relationship with it when I was younger was that I thought it was funny. But it's so good. That's how everything happens. It starts off funny.
Also, them just, like, playing it straight. Like songs like this that are studio constructions can, like, really live or die, like, a quite an awkward death.
Totally.
And this is fucking sick.
Yeah, they're kind of just, like, jamming a bit.
Yeah.
But not like the Fallen Interlude, which was pretty rough when they were playing it live. Wait till the Posse Cut debuts it live.
You know what? I'm glad to hear Tom still singing like Tom now.
It's true.
Like, I was worried he'd try to sound too good because he's, like, on stage with Robert Smith, but he's just doing him.
I'm just, like, trying to imagine a scenario where Blink-182 kept getting more and more and more pretentious.
Yeah.
It could have been so cool. They, like, release an album with Einzerstein Neubauten or whatever.
Right,
or, like,
I'm just thinking of them, like, going through, like, sort of, like, influential, like, you know, British post-punk luminaries. So, like, the next album has Mark E. Smith on it, you know?
They do an album with the band Alternative.
Yeah. There's, like, a very misguided song with John Lydon, like, kind of doing his John Lydon rap thing.
Oh, that'd be so cool.
Yeah.
John Lydon's one of the ones who got away in terms of getting him on the pod. We tried.
I've been listening to, because it's used in an episode of The Sopranos I just watched, the, what is it, World Domination, Africa Bambaataa, and John Lydon. It's like the greatest fucking song in the world. Like, I have not given John Lydon enough respect in my life.
It's true.
Man, I mean, has done a lot of cool shit, you know?
I'm pretty sure both him and Africa Bambaataa are both canceled now, but pretty good.
Well, fuck me, eh? Is John Lydon like a bad, like a...
I think he's just a big-time MAGA guy.
Oh, yeah, but even that just seemed like, that was full-on, like, I don't know, I interpreted that all as,
it's like him being, like, it's him being funny.
Yeah, like adolescent troll shit, you know?
I feel like Africa Bambaataa, there was something, maybe I'm wrong.
Yeah, I don't know about that either.
It's giving me pause to be talking about it, so I feel like I should listen to my heart.
Listen to your heart.
There's a number three on his Wikipedia.
I was like, let's check out the controversy tab, but no, there is no controversy tab, unfortunately. It starts with different. A C.
It still starts with a C, but Sam, I gotta be true to myself and I gotta follow my heart, and I have to be true to you and I have to be true to the podcast and I have to be true to everyone and say, I searched Blink all of this cover. I have no idea how this happened, but there's a video called What Happens When You Toothpaste Into a Motor.
Okay.
And I don't know what it is, but I just have to follow my heart.
There we go. Right. That'll do.
This is a 14-minute video.
What was that?
For some reason, it's overdubbed.
You better hack off these nails.
It's overdubbed with someone who sounds like they're making fun of it, kind of.
And we'll be fine.
And the car is full of nails.
We're coming at you with another nutty episode. We've already featured a few videos about this car on our main channel. If I'm being honest, the engine has to be silenced. We've received a ton of requests from people who...
This seems like a dub that someone's made, like a fan dub of like a Russian YouTube car channel?
Or maybe some grinding powder, polish. It'd be interesting to find
like
out
a sort of like
motor.
Car today, Mythbusters like we'll stunt be show because this car that this guy's in front of is like old and covered
now
in spikes.
Grinding paste should help us get there.
And he's
it for the very end of the video. Meanwhile, we're gonna kick this off with some toothpaste and polish. Right, enough talk. Let's go ahead and pour it in.
Right, enough talk.
Listen for any knocking. Let's do this. So we've decided to start with the toothpaste. As requested by our viewers, what do we got? Oak bark?
Why is there a full Coca-Cola propping up
the
spike-covered lid?
That's what they're using is to prop open the thing. It's like a full bottle of Coke.
And proceed to starting the car. Not bad. The abrasive particles in the toothpaste.
This one, I don't know why it came up. Like, I tried to be specific with my search,
and it's
but
not
this
like
video found me.
It's in the soundtrack.
So it should contaminate the oil and find its way around. Could you imagine?
What's great is in the background is, I guess, these guys' like actual car, like that they've driven to site with, because they're just like in the middle of the fucking woods with this like Mad Max ass looking car. But their actual car is this like lime green looking neon Civic. This is like a bunch of 50-year-old Russian, like, car guys.
So is it bad to put toothpaste in a motor?
It just doesn't seem like where it's supposed to go. It's for your teeth, Josiah.
Yeah, but I don't know. I don't know much about these kind of things.
Fucking shit.
Yeah, that doesn't seem so good.
Oh, and then something flew out of the car.
Yeah, because of the toothpaste.
What was that?
What was that?
It was like, fuck you guys.
Oh, they censored
it. That's it? What happens when you put toothpaste into an engine? Originally uploaded in November of 2018. Translation and voiceover by BMI Russian.
Huh.
Okay, so here's the situation.
Thanks, man. This is the original channel here is Garage 54.
So the crankshaft pulley, which is located next to
this
the
is like a very Russian
center.
Version of like what's the British show about cars? Like that's exclusively
Top
hosted
Gear.
By racists. Yeah.
It's, yeah. Well, so I think it's hosted by Matt LeBlanc now.
Oh, is Matt LeBlanc racist now?
He must be. I guess they just keep doing things with this nail covered car. It's not even spikes, it's like actual like household nails have filled up the car. So that's what happens when you put toothpaste into a motor. Why does that relate to this? I don't know.
How do they let Matt LeBlanc host like an iconic British TV show? You people got to protect your culture more. I hate to sound, you know, nationalist, but...
No one knows what to do with that guy. He's one, like, every member of Friends had a TV show that's like some sort of meta, like, fake Curb show about being a person from Friends.
Yeah.
I think he had one like that too, and they're just like,
he won an Emmy for it.
Did he?
Yeah, he won. I remember because I was like, the fuck did, like, I was watching the Emmys that, you know, I mean, who am I kidding? I watched the fucking Emmys. and yeah, no, that's not Extras, but it's like,
oh yeah, it's called, I think it's called Episodes.
Episodes, yeah.
Damn, good name.
Damn.
It's like so good. You get it?
I get
it. Do you get it?
I don't know. I'm going to need you to explain it to me, please.
All right. Well, before we get into covers, I got one more thing that kind of found me in my journey on here. Mm. Well, there's quite a few covers, though, but first I got to show you. This is uploaded by Serious Sarah, and it is spelled the Sarah way, like my wife. And this is...
I like calling that the Sarah... Are you a follower of the Sarah way?
there's... I'm trying to think if I can say something. I think I probably could.
Listen, you already said you got stuff that you got to add into this episode. So if it starts to come out of your mouth and it feels wrong, just make a note.
That's true. I think it's fine if I'm vague enough. But there's a person that... We've kind of like, it's funny to move to a new city and like meet new people and then sort of have like new friends, but also be so old and kind of set in your ways that it doesn't really matter. Like the thing, the sort of social things that are awkward when you're younger don't matter anymore. Cause it's just like, if someone sucks, it's almost just funny and you kind of just like it.
Yeah.
If you know, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I get what you're saying.
I have an acquaintance in here in Montreal who's like, just pretty much one of the worst people I've ever met in my life, but it's kind of like, I kind of love it because it's like, I don't know, what is there to, like, who cares? I'm 35. I don't need to make any more friends. It's fine. But this person, like, is just sort of, every once in a while we cross paths with this person and they're just like absolutely horrible to talk to. And one time they said to Sarah, like, yeah, I've always thought that it was really lazy when people name their kids Sarah with no H. And we both like, we both just started like laughing awkwardly, but the person didn't laugh at all. It's like they were serious.
Really?
It's like a genuine thing that they said.
Damn. Well, you know, I hate to say this, but I kind of agree.
The person that you think it was is so accurate. So no.
Yeah, like I can picture it coming out of their mouth for sure. Yeah, that person's a fucking dick.
Yeah, it's true, but no. Anyways, it's kind of amazing.
Oh, yeah. No, I also know that person. That's more surprising to me.
Oh, my God. I could go on forever, but I won't. But that's enough
for that. Wow, that's interesting.
So, yeah, there is a theory out there that spelling it with no H is lazier. But I think it looks nice to have it
H. That seems like a very – maybe that's just like a Montreal theory. Hopefully that opinion is limited to Quebec.
Well, this person is very much not from Montreal, but also they've lived here for a little bit longer than us, but they're already like the kind of person who like complains about people coming in from the suburbs or like, you know,
to be fair, I do think that person's probably lived there for like 10 years, maybe.
Okay. Well, either way,
I'm not defending that particular comment, but you know,
you do know this person.
Oh, I absolutely know that person.
And what's your opinion?
I always liked them. That's why I'm a little surprised by that comment. But you know what? Fuck them.
There's about a dozen of them that I could go on about, and it's pretty hilarious. But anyways, Serious Sarah. This is Serious Sarah's four-month anniversary of being a hula hooper. This is uploaded 11 years ago. She celebrated with a nice hoop session to All of This by Blink-182. So you can just see... warming up a little.
Just getting ready for that hoop sesh. That hoopy S. So sorry, which anniversary was this of hooping?
4 months, I believe. She's still a
And this was 11
fresh.
Years ago.
Yeah, so, I mean, hopefully she stuck
so
with
they,
it.
They've been hooping now for 11 years and 4 months. I can't even hear months. The song because I have the volume turned down so I can...
She kind of gets into the rhythm of it, but then the hoop goes flying across the room. Spoiler alert.
This is very good accident.
She's pretty good. Maybe she throws it on purpose.
Yeah, like this person, like, you're telling me.
Let's see.
Oh, yeah. Well, no, see, okay, that's nice.
That wasn't on purpose.
You're telling me. I would maybe restart the video. What else is on the channel? Have they kept going?
Serious Sarah?
I mean, they are like.
Well, 10 years ago, she hooped to Everlast.
Whoa.
And 11 years ago, there was also 30 seconds with no sound.
Huh.
That's pretty good.
Maybe I'm going to get into hula hooping in the fall.
I can't wait for this episode to finish so I can tell you more about this person.
Yeah, because I feel like you're kind of holding back, and I'm, like, super interested. Should we just, like, pause doing the episode? Sorry, hula hoop move is, like, more aggressive and strange than the others. Like, it's like a...
It's like hip-hop dancing.
Yeah, like...
It's like street hula hooping.
Yeah. Like, that's kind it's of like the vibe I get. It's like it's like a rap music video now.
It's so funny that, like, marionette move that she does.
Yeah, like, what the fuck? This is great.
It's really good. Whoa, cool hoop gallop.
Yeah. Now, do you think, like, when you're good at hooping like this, are you just, like, freestyling, like, seeing where the music takes you? Like, you've kind of got a set number of moves? Or do you think she, like, choreographed this in advance?
I mean, I guess this song has enough sort of... It doesn't change that much. And that's maybe one thing that I don't hate it, but I do find this song is so much more vibey than Blink songs that are so aggressively part-based.
Right.
So that does make it good for kind of a freestyle hoop session because it is so samey throughout.
Yeah, totally. Freestyle hooping.
All right. How about I pee and then we have a quick goss that I forget to edit out and get in a lot of trouble?
Okay, that sounds great.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, nothing to see here. Time to continue the episode.
Yeah.
We've just watched the lady hooping and the toothpaste car. And now it's time to get into some covers.
Oh, like
Sam.
Either that or like we have no friends anymore.
If we leave this in? Yeah, I know.
It's one or the other.
This part. You want me to edit out this from now on? Keep in everything up until right now?
Yeah, no. I think you should include this.
Okay, so when do you want me to stop including things?
When do I want you to stop including things?
Like now, should I edit out everything? Because the whole episode from now until now is going in.
Yeah, the whole episode until now is going in. So if you can stop now and we'll go pee and then we'll start again and we'll do covers.
Okay, perfect.
Okay.
I don't think this song lends itself to Nightcore. I'm making an executive decision. We're going to start with some remixes instead.
We kind of heard Nightcore. The Nightcore version, like, live featuring actual Robert Smith anyway.
So this is a remix by Noel Wiki. It's very odd, and I think there's a lot of photos of white people with dreadlocks in this video.
Oh.
So far, it's just a slow zoom in on this guy's spaced earlobes.
Tiny spacer. Like, I know it's
what kind of remix is this?
It just sort of sounds like Enjoy the Silence. Oh.
Also, why is it so long?
I don't know. This is a 6.5 minute song. I feel like they've just layered two songs on top of each other.
I think you're right.
And the other one, I don't know what it is, but it's...
It sucks ass.
Oh, this is like really unpleasant.
It's What Else Is There by Royksopp and All of This by Blink-182.
Okay.
I guess this is Scarlett Johansson, maybe? Maybe it was a different one of these awful remixes that had dreadlock people.
Yeah, because it's just all black and white photos of people looking thoughtful and so.
Oh no, here we go. Here's like some sort of forest nymph. She's half there. She's disappeared.
Damn.
Wow. Absolutely terrible.
Give me a fucking headache.
That was really horrible.
Yeah.
Really, really bad. We're experiencing the full range of emotions. This is Cyan's Time Crunch remix of the song.
Ah, Time Crunch.
It's called that. Same length or longer than the original. Is that a real photo of them with Robert Smith? That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Wait, this is for...
Not enough time.
that was my voice.
Wait, what?
I didn't know that was literally my voice.
Okay, start from the beginning.
Yes, I did a blink at it. Don't at me. Hashtag Robert Smith. Hashtag Joe's. Hashtag
we're in time crunch right now. That's not enough time.
Did you say
That's not enough time.
I'm not gonna lie, that was pretty surreal fucking feeling.
It's also confusing my own voice. I was like, wait, are you talking? Because there was like other clips of you. I was like, wait, what's happening right now? Like, I'm hearing double for Josiah. Is that the only clip of you in there? It's just, it's a time crash.
I have no idea. What music is this?
Time crunch music, baby.
I hope. Ooh, there's some. It sounds like Hot Chip. You just said again.
What the fuck?
I
was so confused because you keep saying that to me, and I'm like, I'm not saying anything.
Over and over again. Same riffs over and over again.
Weird.
My jaw is open. That's the face I've made.
I didn't even really listen to it before we played it. I was just like, oh, it's like some sort of weird like indie disco version of it. And I guess I was attracted to the phrase time crunch.
What the fuck?
I love that it's just you saying on it.
Yeah, why is that all I got? terrible cover.
Thank you, Cyan from Oxford, UK.
Yeah, that was great.
That was really good and just very disorienting.
Yeah, super. It was confusing who was talking to me.
I feel very disoriented now.
Yeah.
Because I was also like, wait, I don't feel my mouth moving while we listen to this, no. But why am I talking?
And then you mean like, you said and I was like, what's he saying? Why is he saying that to me?
You did.
I know, I'd see now. I didn't see then.
Oh, God. This could be the last episode and it would be completely fine.
I think we've closed some really like important thoughts off, you know? Like, I think we've resolved some shit.
And we've canceled ourselves if I leave in all the shit talk.
It's true, yeah. We just can't go back.
Here's a piano version by KOMX, who we all know and love. Ooh. Just kidding. No disrespect to this guy, but I feel like it's a next level of nerd to have like a real electronic piano in your house. Like, not an actual piano and not like a MIDI keyboard,
yeah,
but like a weighted keys electronic piano. That's like, I don't know.
That's dork.
I respect how nerdy it is.
I also feel like
he definitely has a Cimmerillion poster behind him.
I definitely feel like sometimes we get like piano covers that are just like janky MIDI versions or whatever. Like, this sounds quite lovely.
It really does. But that's what I mean. I mean, we need these kind of nerds to make. He's holding his foot down on that pedal that makes it sound all echoey and nice.
Sustain.
You know that one? Sustain. Overruled.
That's the other pedal. Being good at piano must be like so satisfying.
My dad is like crazy sick at piano.
Because it's not annoying the way being good at guitar is. Like, I don't think anyone is ever like stoked that you're good at guitar.
Really, you think?
I think like in very specific contexts, being good at guitar is honestly exciting. I think in every context, being good at piano is exciting. Like if you're at a party and someone's like, "Oh, you've got a piano? Do you guys want to like have a little Billy Joel fucking sing along? Like, are you telling me it'd be great?" Whereas like same person pulls out the acoustic and starts playing Oasis songs.
Oh well, that's not good at guitar to just play chords though.
Right. Okay. Same person is like, "Oh, you've got a guitar." They pull out a guitar and starts fucking
shredding, and there's like smoke coming off of the strings because they're so good. You're telling me that they're not going to be the hero of the evening?
That would actually be like the highlight of the party for sure. Well, I dabble. Nice one,
KXMX. I wish that it had more samples of us talking in it, I guess. It's my only complaint.
Try harder next time.
This next one I haven't watched. I haven't really checked any of these. I just went vibe-based with most of them. This one gives me a very strong vibe. Just like even before I hit play, just read the title and the names and everything.
All right, so this is
by someone named J-A-E-M, Jame, featuring Nomi with a umlaut. I doubt that's Klaus Nomi, but it could be pretty cool if it was. Yeah. And then someone named Binster. Yeah,
what vowels are missing there? Bunster?
Bannister?
I read it as Bunster. That was like my immediate
Bunstar. It's all caps BNSTR. Binster. You know, Binster on the beat.
I've been working on my squats, trying to become a bun star, you know?
Right, exactly. So, I mean, there's a great Max Res default that I can see. I don't think you can, but this is Jame from the channel Official Jame featuring Nomi and Binster. Well, they all have their own different logos at the start, too.
Oh, yeah. A gothy teen.
It's like so... the light leaks, the handheld camera. With all of this I know now, everything inside of my head, it all just he's wearing sandals. He's leaning against the window. There's like light leaking into the room, perfectly illuminating his man bun. How's your man bun, Sam?
I'm not wearing it at present.
You're not a bun star then.
No, I'm simply the banister today. I haven't worn it since I was rocking the top bun for the back to school Twitch stream.
Now he's switched to his bed, or he's sitting in the stairs being sad.
Turns out it's quite possible to make this song bad.
Yeah, big time. So where's Nomi and Bunstar? You think they'll come in now?
Do you think this is... These are two different people.
Are you sure?
Yeah. No.
I think it's the same guy. He just changed his hair and his location.
Well, it's working for me. Is this the same guy?
No, maybe it's not. Maybe you're right.
One of these guys is Jame. One of them is Nomi. But I am waiting for Bunstar.
Where's Bunstar?
I think we'll know them.
This is a lush production, though.
Yeah. The sun coming through those windows.
It's crazy. There's like all this piano in the background. Oh, yeah, you're right. This is a different guy. That's Nomi, probably.
Yeah, their voices are different.
But is this a different guy too? Is that a third guy?
Oh,
no,
yeah.
That's the same guy as the stairs.
Okay,
I think
the stairwell guy
and the bad guy are just.
And the bad guy
here
are
we go.
Different.
Here's
Bunstar.
This
is Bunstar. Okay, this is a new guy.
Oh, this guy's crazy good. He's got a really thin teen mustache.
Yeah.
Is he shitting? Oh my! Wait, did you see that? Is this a joke?
I can't even tell what position he's in there.
He's sitting on a toilet with his pants down, taking a shit.
Hold on. Because when you pause it, I get like a, okay, go back a little bit and let's just watch it one more time.
Watch.
He's taking a shit.
Wait, what? Why? This is the most serious video I've ever seen in my life, and Bun starts taking a shit?
Yeah, because it's like moody bed, moody empty room, moody
stairwell. Is Bunstar maybe the prankster of the group?
Well, yeah, with a name like Bunstar, and that's why he's on the toilet.
So, but literally no one in the cover, in the comments has mentioned this.
Because honestly, it is like, it's so backlit. I didn't see it. You had to go and pause it. You had to watch it three times. It's an Easter egg.
Why would they do that?
Oh, wow. All of their talents.
My mind is literally blown at this man taking a shit in the middle of this.
There's only like 30 seconds left, and I would kind of like to know if the toilet appears again.
Like it like zooms in on the shit, yeah. Like the start of Uncut Gems.
Yeah, dude, like that is not
That's
even
the most
a half
fucked up thing I've ever seen
of toilet in a room where he's completely backlit. I didn't see it.
Do you
at
think
all.
Jame or Nomi even noticed? Like, it's so.
No, I think they probably just thought they'd blow it out with the like sunlight through the window. Yeah.
What?
Incredible.
What?
Incredible. Bun Star.
What's like a Bun Star? It says his socials here. Benster is his name.
Ben, okay, I'll read that to you. At BNSTERCPH.
But it's not a Twitter account. Maybe it's an Instagram. There better be some toilet content on here. I'm gonna yeah. be pissed.
Oh, what if I did that? He's like a just a fetish artist.
He's none of the. He's just like a chill guy, observing life from a hero's perspective.
Damn, that's pretty chill, man.
He's a DJ.
Aren't we all?
I guess maybe he. I'm really trying to unpack this, and I'm trying not to be gendered, because I feel like maybe like in a female singer songwriter kind of video, it might have shown a girl on the toilet being emotional because we assume that she's peeing, and so maybe you know what I mean.
Yeah.
Like I feel like I've seen
like
that before.
See
like
that
a
more
girl,
often. It's like we expect like girls love to cry on the toilet,
but then we see this like quite built man, Benster. Sitting on the toilet, and we just assume he's taking a shit.
Yeah.
Which maybe, like, you're allowed to be emotional while you shit, too, I guess.
I love to
but
cry
also,
and shit. A good shitty cry. Just let it out.
That's definitely going on the out-of-context account.
I want that in... Here's the thing. That is in context. That's that's all I mean what I'm saying.
There's nothing to take out. I guess, like... Maybe it's because he's one of those, like, there are guys who sit down while they pee. Mm. Maybe he's doing that and that's why it's okay. Or like, I'm just trying to understand what they're like, we're going to make this look like it costs $30,000 and that it's an ad for like an emerging church that serves coffee around the clock.
And then,
but also we're going to have 0.3 seconds of a guy sitting on a toilet with his pants down while he sings. I mean, this is kind of the most insane thing I've ever seen in my life.
Maybe they're reclaiming what I think you very accurately described as like sort of a gendered stereotype. You know, like if a music video has like a woman sitting on a toilet, you know, looking sad, you kind of don't really think twice about it. Because as far as we know, as dudes, that's where girls go to be sad. Upon the toilet.
I love also that we just knew that Bunstar was going to be an important person. And
yeah,
we might not have waited.
Fixating on it for 5 minutes.
We might not have waited, but then we did and we got the shots.
He's just straight up on the toilet.
There's also, in the closer cut, there. I'm pretty sure it shows a candle. Like, he's taking a stinky shit.
Oh, yeah. What is that on the windowsill?
I think it's a candle to get all his poo fumes out of there.
Maybe they just had, like, no time. They had to blast out the shot, and he had to blast one out. He's straight up on their toilet. And I feel like, can we see his thigh? Like you had said originally, like it looks to me like a person whose pants are down.
No, you can see. Like you can see that there's no separation. It's pure thigh to leg to near his shin and calf. You can see the bunched up pants. This man is taking a shit. And I think the more I think about it, the more I think that maybe they wanted to have another location in their dorm or whatever.
Yeah.
And they thought, you know, we need him to sit somewhere. And it doesn't feel natural to sit on a toilet with your pants on. Maybe they just love the light leaks. But they're like, well, we should probably make it look realistic.
Yeah, it's got to be. It's, again, we've been talking a lot about the authenticity of the song, you know.
I somehow feel like this. I think I'm just really tired. It's been a long week for me as well, but I do feel like this is somehow the most important discovery of my entire life.
Okay, well, you definitely got to screen cap what we're both looking at right now and share. Yeah. Maybe now.
Well, if I did, okay, I'll crop out the
the song title. Yeah.
Yeah.
Just get those buns okay. Starring.
I'll just do a bit of a closer crop. Okay, that's perfect. I'm gonna share it right now.
Okay. This man is so clearly like the seat is up.
He's like, taking a shit.
He's,
and you don't get to that level of pondering unless it's a difficult shit. True. Of some sort.
I wrote like a pretty long email on the toilet today because it was a ponderous shit, you know? But it gives you time to sort of get in your thoughts.
There's still a lot to get through, but I'm going to be thinking about this one for the rest of my life.
Bunstar, yeah, forever in our hearts.
This is a guy named Julian Grimm, and Julian Grimm said that he usually likes to change up the covers, which I respect, but he said he tried to reverse engineer the song to sound like the original. So he looks like a pretty cool guy, and he has a nice Vox amp. But on the max res default of this video, he is using the Angry Birds font as well. So hard to get the vibe, really.
This guy looks like every member of Broken Social Scene that like isn't Kevin Drew or Brandon King.
To me, he looks like every member of American football.
Oh yeah.
Man, people love to like compose shots for their YouTube shit for this song.
I kind of like this because it's like there's this locked off shot of him next to the Vox amp, and just periodically like the instruments will sort of appear or disappear from his hands, but he's got the same like downward sad dog.
But then it cuts to this like really close shot.
Yeah, I would prefer not to see that shot.
I really didn't like my Vox amp, but I do think they're very pretty looking.
Oh, yeah.
Too muddy for me, though.
Yeah, but they look nice.
I mean, you know what? Respect for getting it so accurate.
Yeah, that was fucking great.
And for kind of looking like a dreamy lost Kinsella brother.
Yeah, the sixth Kinsella.
Which again, another private conversation we had today that was quite enjoyable to tell you about that I can't tell anyone else about.
Damn, it's a lot of private treats for me tonight.
This one is just way too British, and I think it is. Unfortunately, British people are canceled. After the McFly thing,
oh, yeah.
Too.
This photo is so British.
It's so British.
Just three...
three fucking Minecraft creeps. All of this I know now. Everything
inside of my head. It all just goes to show. I guess this is like the only Blink song that they get to sing. Oh, wow, interesting. Give it a little bit of that.
This is very weird.
Yeah.
Cover.
It's like unsettling.
drums sound so awful.
Yeah.
Dude. It sounds like they don't really know what they're doing, but they're just kind of like, kind of tell what to do. With all of this, I feel now. those guys.
Some really good, variations on the melody.
I think the band was called the Michael Davenport 3, which, of course they are.
Damn.
Fucking trivia night ass band. This next one, now you thought that was, whatever. This next one, I almost feel like, maybe it's just the image, but I feel like this one from a band called The Elephant Period is what I think they're called. I feel like this hits maybe a Hootie territory.
Oh, whoa, okay.
Maybe it's just that guitar pick with an elephant on it. But
yeah, it might have just been the cover art. It's not Hootie enough for me.
Or maybe DMB a little bit? But can't you just picture a puka shell necklace and this guy's waving his hands around a lot while he sings?
Yeah, it's very DMB. Simply the band, as I like to call them now.
Crash into me.
If you just put some wind chime here.
Oh yeah, a sax solo.
Yeah, I want just more of those Carter Buford fills.
Maybe I can just play a sax solo on top of this and it'll work.
Yeah, yeah. Just
okay, I'll try it.
Mash
you
it
won't
up.
Hear it though.
Okay.
Okay, that had a backing track that didn't really work.
You just gotta find solo sax solo.
Promise love that I really enjoy.
Stop talking and play. Kind of works. Sam, you gotta go back and listen to this episode. This is very satisfying. Okay, that's working. I'm gonna get some, what'd you say, wind chimes?
Yeah, wind chimes.
Okay,
deploy.
These all have such long intros. I want to see you make the wind chimes. This guy's introduced. Just play the fucking. And the saxo is in tune with the song. It's so magical.
Would it be too much to ask for a fiddle solo?
The wind chimes are too subtle.
They so rarely are in real life.
Okay, here's a percussion solo.
You realize this makes you Dave Matthews, right? You directing the band this way?
I'm starting to wonder if I've actually died and gone to heaven tonight. This is the greatest night of my life.
I'm really sad that I've missed that.
I'm so sorry. Do you want to? No, you'll have to. We could do it again. The fact that the sax solo was in tune as well.
In the same key. No, you know what? Something for me to look forward to tomorrow.
Yeah, because I know you joke around, but you do listen to the entire pod every week.
Every day. Friday morning. Friday night.
Every day. Over and over again. This is called Balancing the Different. Balancing the Different.
It feels like a Montreal punk band name.
It's true. And it's just like a out of focus picture of a boy.
Or not in Montreal, but like Belgium, you know?
Yeah, totally. This boy is just sitting on a ledge thinking about Holly and the Hoes. I don't know. It's
fine.
Yeah. I mean, I feel like, unfortunately, the song really lends itself to these, like, spiritless acoustic covers.
It's kind of true. Here's a band called Dead Rituals doing it.
Oh.
Which is, like, just such a band name of, like, do we know this band? Someone we know in this band?
Yeah, I was like...
Are they constantly emailing me to do them some sort of favor?
Yeah, I've seen this band at Pooza. Or, like, I said I would see them at Pooza, and instead I just, like, kept drinking it twice.
Kind of sounds good, though.
Yeah, I mean, it sounds good because it's kind of the song, right? But, like, the email voice in there is awesome. Very curious if this is somehow actually a band that we know. Oh, this is good.
Yeah, I do kind of wish they had changed, yeah, like, the guitars a bit or something.
Yeah, because, like, the voices are really nice. Oh, this band is from Naples. I know no one there.
Right. Yeah, just change it a bit more next time, Dead Rituals from Naples, Italy.
Because, like, it sort of reminds me a little bit of, Naples.
Are you talking right now? I can't hear you. Turn the music down. What does it remind you of?
It reminds me of something, but I don't want to get it wrong.
Okay. Well, it reminds me of the morning dew.
Yeah.
And,
oh, fuck.
A hug from a kitten. And,
oh, my God. This sucks. This is... I can't... it's a band that has, like, been on the pod, and so and I just can't remember their name, which is annoying.
Oh. Is it this?
No.
Okay.
Can you help me out here?
Do you want me to edit this so that you're not embarrassed?
No,
you
it's
can't
fine.
The
you
name?
Just fucking say it. Like it.
The world is a beautiful
yes.
place and I am no longer afraid
Thank
to die.
You.
I mean, that's a lot to remember. That's like remembering... three emo band names or like 10 normal band names.
And the problem,
so that makes sense.
The problem is that again, we're getting pretty late. This is like, I'm like, today's been long. I'm just excuses or not excuses, but just hopefully I beg for understanding. And so I was like, is it, I love you, but I've chosen darkness. Is it, and so I watch you from afar. Which one of these?
I think we should end things.
Yeah.
Or
yeah.
I think you should leave.
But like their cover of In Circles that they put out like a little bit earlier in the pandemic is like so sick. Cause it's like fairly in the same vein as this, like kind of functionally kind of a straightforward, like pretty true to form cover, except that like they've replaced the like high Jeremy voice with like a female voice. And it just sounds like it's just the range is crazy. And then it gets obviously way more like fucking post Rocky and sick.
Well, that's great.
Thanks.
This is by Bailey Woods. Bailey spelled with two E's, which I think is the lazy way to spell it. Just kidding. This is her cover. This is the caption. A cover done really badly, but hey, are you kidding me? This is
no,
fucking
this is like
beautiful.
Super sick. It's just like nice to hear someone doing something different with it acoustic.
stopped it at the 155 mark. That is fucking beautiful.
That was fucking gorgeous. That was truly fucking lovely.
That's, I mean, I'm
what's their name
hesitant.
Again? I just want to like, what, that gave is, me like full on like, that was like ST Manville level of like respect for an imaginative way of doing something that could be so fucking like hack.
This is Bailey Woods, B-A-I-L-E-E, and then Woods. And this is on YouTube, but I don't know if Bailey Woods has like Bandcamp
or
something.
Bailey Woods, get on Bandcamp.
Like, what the fuck? That was I think Bailey Woods is in a band called House Panther, perhaps. From Winnipeg.
Oh. House cool. Panther is honestly a sick band name too.
It's really good. Damn, Bailey Woods, you rule. Shout out to Winnipeg. Yeah. Was that on this episode we were talking about that?
What, the Weaker Dance?
Or was that the other
that
one?
That might have been the other episode. I don't know. Again, a great reason to maybe, I guess, pay us more money.
Yeah, patreon.com/blink155.
Yeah.
Okay, this is the last one, and I think this kind of, I was expecting a little bit more of this than I found, but I feel like this song does kind of fit into the SoundCloud rap, Lil Peep kind of
yeah,
realm.
Yeah, that's interesting.
So this is a Doomer version by Clean Syringe. It's more of a remix than a cover, but I think it's very satisfying. Completely lost in that.
The visual's great.
And the scratchiness. Let's keep it under the backing track while we conclude this shit.
Well, Josiah, what are your final thoughts on the song I'll Have This by the band Blink-182 featuring Robert Smith?
It's you were right. It's in my top 10.
Really?
Are you being, it's crept in.
Like,
it's so, there's something about it that is just like, first of all,
I'm sorry, a song I was even like middling on to start has broken the top 10 of 178 songs.
For now, because I think there's something about
toilet?
This. There's something about it that it is the toilet, and it's this Doomer cover and Bailey, and it's like, it contains the multitude of emotion. Like, there's something, this is a key to understanding this band and understanding ourselves. And there's something magical about it, and there's something magical about this episode. And I was, even though I was listening to it earlier, I was getting a little bit misty just listening to the song. It's like so nostalgic and sad. I guess I just thought it was like too repetitive and I used to make fun of it, but that's fine. I'm done with that. This is in the top 10 for sure. It's sick.
I mean, I fucking agree. You know, it's interesting thinking about like the nostalgia aspect of it, because this feels like a song that is unique, and because there are things that do this where like this felt emotionally resonant to me when I heard it for the first time in my 20s, whenever this came out, like early 20s. And then when I listen to it now, like when I put this on a playlist and like go out for a walk, it's not a pure nostalgia thing. Like, I still feel like emotionally connected to this song, you know, in a way that I think like the best Blink songs still make me feel, you know, the way that other like truly great songs, you know, can connect with you at various points in your life. And I think like that's remarkable. And the sweetness of the whole Robert Smith thing really fucking got to me. And, I'm like, this is actually top five for me. So I get it. I totally get it. There's an energy to this and this notion that I think we've circled so much of what would have happened if this band had just stayed broken up. And this feels like the purest, you know, in a way that other songs that are experimental on this album, like, exemplify, I think, that notion that we kind of have, like, discussed. Like, this is fully that. And in that sense, it also feels like this, like, document, like, this snapshot, to use the image of Tom that we keep seeing. Like, this is, like, a snapshot of the future of this band that we never got. And that's simultaneously very sad and also, like, very special that, like, this song gets to exist in the career of a band that, like, still plays in front of a giant sign that says fuck that they've had for, like, 20 years. It's cool.
Welcome to Blink 155. To Wes Eisold of American Nightmare and of Cold Cave. I'm so excited to have you here because the guests I always remember are the ones that take some pleading to get on the show.
Yeah, that's me.
So I guess to get it out of the way, I promised you we weren't going to talk about it too much. What is your status as a existing or non-existent Blink-182 fan?
I'm pretty indifferent to the band. I don't listen to them. I never really did. You know, there's been some crossover in my history with them, particularly with American Nightmare. You know, two of the members had a clothing company called, Atticus that I guess endorsed or sponsored or something American Nightmare. It put us on compilations, gave us clothes on tour and stuff like that. But even then I was pretty indifferent to it. It wasn't something I was really trying to represent or cared about, though I appreciated, you know, the care and I don't know, the acknowledgement and wanting to promote the band.
Right, for sure. But I guess I am curious though, like, did you ever have a pop punk phase before you've always had it feels like you've had a clearly defined aesthetic with everything you've tried to do, whether it's hardcore or post-punk, you kind of know exactly what you're doing. But did you have like a goofy, like, have you ever listened to like NoFX or MXPX or something?
I've listened to NoFX like I was in ninth grade when Punk and Drublick came out, and I had that CD. Most of my pop punk listening kind of revolved around like Descendants or Jawbreaker, and then I guess Lifetime after that, and that's really the extent of it. I mean, I consumed music at such a high rate growing up. I bought CDs or 7-inches literally every day of school because I would save my lunch money and just buy a record instead, because records were like $2.50, $3 then. So I definitely have probably owned a lot of material that fell under the umbrella of pop punk, but it was never my go-to music. Though, I mean, there are things I liked, like trying to think of what else, you know, I liked Sam I Am a little bit, and I don't know, I've never heard MXPX though, because I think there was a stigma around them that they were a Christian band, and that was just a no growing up, so.
Yeah, you know. That's fair. What about like in terms of, I'm just trying to picture you, like, would you ever sit in your room and listen to music that you knew was like silly or funny?
Not really. I'm not really a funny music person. I enjoy humor. But when it comes to music, it's never was really attractive to me.
Right.
I'm sure if you gave examples, I could say yes or no, but like off the top of my head, when I think about listening to funny music, it never really happened. Even when I liked Descendants, I would skip all the stupid songs, you know?
Right. Fair. Well, then that's perfect, because you're here to talk about a song that kind of sounds nothing like Blink-182 and is super kind of serious. But I guess before we get into the specific song, something else I want to ask you about is, like, I don't know if you're kind of – it's weird to almost talk to you about it, because it's more of a cultural thing, but I don't know if you're kind of like the pioneer of this pivot or if there's other people who've done it, but I'm curious about people who like go from hardcore and Bridge Nine Records and stuff like that, and then get like fully into kind of whatever you want to call it, gothy post-punk kind of culture. What do you think is the draw that brings you from one of those worlds to the other?
I can't speak for anyone else, but for me, that was the music I listened to growing up the most. Like, my favorite bands were The Cure and Sisters of Mercy and Bauhaus and New Order and Joy Division and stuff like that. And that theme carried through American Nightmare, even with obviously not musical influences, but definitely thematically and even aesthetically to a point. So for me, once I decided that I wanted to make music by myself, that was where I naturally went to, for a variety of reasons, taste and then just means. That was the music I was able to make with my limited musical abilities / understanding. So I think when I started doing that, there was no scene or world for that. I didn't consider any contemporaries that I had seen go from like hardcore to a serious sort of synth based darker band that I could think of.
Right.
So it just never crossed my mind that that was something that would happen more in the future. I don't know. It was really natural for me. That's the music I always listened to. And when it came time to make my own music, I just gravitated there.
Right. Okay. That makes sense. Because I do think it's interesting, even knowing that the other kind of question I want to ask you about Blink-182 is like, did you think that when you were younger or even now, like, was it like something to do with, you know, them seeming mainstream or on a major light? Like, were those the kind of things that crossed your mind too when you were younger?
By the time that band, by the time I was aware of that band, that wasn't something I was really concerned with.
Yeah.
Again, because a lot of the bands I grew up with were, you know, I was old enough to understand that there's a difference between bands who have longevity and they just grow to a certain fan base, and certain labels make sense for them after a certain point. Like, for instance, The Cure, you know, they weren't always a popular band. They just grew, and all of a sudden people in your school are listening to it, whatever, it's on TV, it's on the radio everywhere you go, but it doesn't make them less of a band.
Right.
So I remember around the time AN started and being really into hardcore, there were for sure some suspect bands that you never really went to because there was just something off about it. But at the same time, there were bands like Sick of It All who were on major labels that didn't affect the way I thought of that band or if I listened to him or not. You know, it's really a case by case situation for bands. Like, you know, I knew who Blink-182 were, and I knew that they were a San Diego band and had been around for a while. So when they were popular, it wasn't like, was this bullshit co-opting punk or whatever. That didn't matter to me, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Fair. Okay. Well, I guess I think it's interesting. Kind of, I know that Mark from Blink-182 grew up kind of obsessed with a lot of the bands that you've mentioned as being influential to you, and they always wanted to kind of emulate The Cure a little bit, and I think you can hear it a little bit in their songwriting, obviously not as well, but it's just interesting to me that maybe things that are punk and hardcore adjacent were so influenced by The Cure, and I'm just curious, like, in what way do you think that trickled down through culture?
Well, God, I think they just had such an impact on people, particularly in the 80s, because they stood out. First of all, they were a different type of band. They kind of attracted listeners from all different sorts of, different genres. Like, it was okay for people I knew into metal to listen to them, or hardcore or punk or hip hop or anything. Like, they were just one of those bands that transcends genre, really, because I think they were such an entity of their own that I'm sure you can find parallels and influences in all sorts of music. You know, it was just sort of like, you know, The Cure were different than like The Smiths or something, because it was more about atmosphere than, I don't know, the lyrical aspect. Not to say that Cure lyrics weren't important, but it was just a different take on it. It was more about a general mood, and but it wasn't singular in that every song was like gloom and depressing. You know, they went really back and forth between upbeat, happy songs to, you know, what I just mentioned. But, you know, I wouldn't say that, like, you know, I don't, if you listen to Blink-182, I wouldn't like say, oh, that sounds like The Cure or something like that, right. You know, but I'm sure like going back, you can hear their influence in like Smashing Pumpkins in like late 80s, early 90s or something like that, as opposed to like Blink-182. By that point, it seemed like probably just a different thing altogether.
Right. But Blink-182 are the ones who somehow managed to finagle a Robert Smith guest spot on their self-titled record. I mean, had you ever heard this song before? And I did notice you mentioned you listened to the song before you wrote me back. I wasn't going to make you listen to it if you didn't want to, but I'm glad that you did.
I heard it sometime around the time it came out, just because I always pay attention to what Robert Smith does, but that doesn't mean that I think it's like good song or something like that, you know?
Right.
You know, that was like a questionable sort of era for The Cure. You know, a few years after that, he did like a Korn collaboration. And so I don't think like saying Blink-182.
Do you like Korn?
No, of course not.
It seems, because like, doesn't it seem like Korn, I think Korn has kind of, is one of the, like nu metal is one of those things that the younger generation has really embraced, whether tongue in cheek or not. It does seem like, you know, that's another thing that's come around.
You know, everything comes back. I don't know. And people romanticize an era of their life when things seem simpler and happier. And, you know, and then there's people who missed it altogether who it might sound good to. I never listened to anything like that, you know.
Right.
I never have heard a Korn record or owned something by them. You know, it was, and I don't mean that to put them down. It just wasn't my thing, you know?
Well, I guess, I'm sorry, you were making a point, but this is so interesting to me. Like, have you ever listened to, do you ever listen to things like ironically or in a tongue in cheek way?
Not really. I mean, I for example, you mentioned the song and Do We Want to Talk? And I listened to it and then it sort of led me down a very brief rabbit hole of listening to Blink cover A Letter to Elise live. And then I remember the Korn thing and listened to that. And it's like, I don't like the way any of that sounds.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think it's good per se. At the same time, I appreciate that these bands who are in these positions, like highly popular, like Blink and Korn, get to turn people on to a band like The Cure who perhaps their fans had not heard them before, and that they have the means to give back and show public appreciation for an artist who is important to them. I think that's more important than the song being forgettable or not that great or whatever, you know?
Right. Something I find about The Cure is that it seems like I know like the hits and I've heard some stuff, but I find the discography to be like so much huger than I even realized, and it's almost daunting. And so I'm curious, like, does this song, you were kind of hinting at it, but does this song sound like The Cure from some era that I've never heard?
It's not that dissimilar from like sort of that weird era of mid-2000s Cure that, you know, those sort of record, like there's the record that Ross Robinson produced, which in the lineage of Cure records isn't a great Cure record, but if you're just an overall fan of the band and Robert's songwriting, then there are things to find in it if you are willing to. You know, it's not like putting on Disintegration or right. Wish or Pornography. You know, it's like it takes a little more effort. But I like that about bands, and I like sort of being committed to a band, whether they're doing exactly what you want or not. And for instance, when that record came out, the Cure record, it did nothing for me. But over the past few years, I've kind of grown to appreciate it and enjoy it, just because it's like this band at this weird time. They've been around so long and have created so much beautiful material. Then you know, it's different to try to imagine what it's like to be inside of that band and make decisions and choices and carry on and not just fall back upon your old catalog. And, you know, I appreciate listening from that angle of what are we supposed to do now? Let's try this, you know, even if it totally doesn't really always work 100%, you know?
I mean, I have profoundly cornier taste than you, but I agree. And that reminds me of, like, I guess the coolest example I could think of for me is like someone like Neil Young, where it's like, he's been around so long. There's so many records, and even the ones that suck, it's like interesting to just get another angle of the process. And then the really embarrassing example that I don't even want to say out loud is that I do like new Weezer as well.
Right. I mean, I liked the first two Weezer records, so I guess they didn't seem like silly to me at the time, though, in a way, you know, because I think it's presented with such sincerity that even though there's like sort of like goofy references and stuff, it didn't bother me. But I also didn't like love the band either.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. I mean, that's what I mean is, like, even they did have like a really goofy phase, but now they're like older guys who are trying to still trying to perfect a power pop song. And it's just interesting to see, even though like I understand people who hate it, it's interesting to just be like, I've been following this story this whole time, so I'm going to listen to these records that are like kind of difficult to listen to, but it's just gives you another angle.
Whatever moves you.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. I don't know. Like, I assume then you're probably not very used to Tom DeLonge's voice, which might have been jarring, especially jarring beside Robert Smith on this song.
I'm, you know, it is jarring, but I think there's something sort of cute about it, in that's the voice he has, that's how they sing, and this is something they wanted to do. And, you know, I don't know who the song's for. It just seems like something they wanted to do, and there's nothing that, you know, you can't really criticize that, I think, you know?
Yeah. It's like kind of like a flex that they're even able to do it.
Yeah. And I think, you know, I think they were popular enough, and the Cure was sort of at a weird point where it just made sense. Like, you know, I remember like in around the same time seeing this email between, and I probably shouldn't even say this, but I was forwarded some emails from Morrissey to people from the band Fall Out Boy, and he was trying to like do shows with them, which is like, now it sounds like the worst fucking idea in the world. But like, I can imagine being at this weird point in your career in mid-2000s, which was a weird time for a lot of older musicians from the 80s and early 90s, I think. You know, a lot of bands, even from the early 90s, started making questionable records, and they'd just been around long enough at that point where it was confusing as to what to do, not only to stay relevant, because those bands always fluctuated in their relevance anyway. They're cult bands. I don't think they were concerned with relevance, but I think it hit a point where they were looking outside of themselves for what's next, and also made music that sort of reflected that confusing time, you know? Right. And I think both bands have like gotten, both artists I just mentioned have gotten over that and just gone on to do what they should be doing, as opposed to looking for who is the popular producer now and who are the popular bands on TV that we should play with, you know?
Yeah. You've given me the segue that I wanted, but I want to pause for a second there, because I mean, we talked about punk, you know, whether or not something's fake punk or whatever, the major label thing and that kind of case by case thing. What about now in the last 10 to 20 years, things like quote unquote goth or whatever have become so like commodified or whatever? Is there like fake goth, or like, do you get bummed out when people are like co-opting these aesthetics or these looks?
I don't get bummed out, but yeah, there's fake everything. That's just the nature of the world and entertainment and music and art. So I don't get bummed out. There's not like a popular fake goth band that I'm like, damn, I wish I was in that band. And when I was in American Nightmare playing a hardcore band, you know, there wasn't a popular hardcore band that I was like, fuck them, like, this is who we should be, that pop, like, it just wasn't like that for me, and it still isn't. That said, I definitely shared band members with people who did feel like that, and it eventually wore them down, and it made them crazy. And you know, like, there was a person in American Nightmare who basically went crazy when AFI got popular and like called the record label and was like, why aren't we on the radio? What the fuck is going on? This is bullshit. And like, no one else in the band shared this sentiment or idea or jealousy or whatever. And it soured things with AN's, you know, record label at the time. And it was just bizarre, and people never really recovered from that jealousy, you know? And, I've always just sort of taken the approach that I just want to do things that I think are cool, make music that I think is cool, and that's enough for me. And if people catch on to it, great. If not, I don't care either. And that's really what AN was at the time when it started. There was nothing that sounded like us. The band got popular pretty fast. But, you know, once you start getting popular in a certain scene, it comes with a lot of negativity also. So I've been able to sort of tune out all that. There's things that I think suck for sure, but right. I think most music sucks. Like, when you ask me if there's fake goth bands, nothing comes to my mind of what I think sucks or fakes. I give it so little attention. Whereas if you ask me, what do you think of this band? I'd be like, it's okay. It's not for me, or it's bullshit, you know?
Right.
But aside from that, it's not really consuming much room in my head, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Fair. I mean, I would hope so at this point in your life. We all, but I hope that
you'd be surprised, you know, there's a lot of people, you know, trying to write music to outdo other people, you know, that's a thing. And, you know, you see it with small bands, you see it with large bands. And, there's just like these like beefs that people carry in their heads that don't really exist, that drive them, and maybe they need that, and maybe without these like imaginary competitions, they would not produce anything, you know?
Yeah, that's true.
I think like a running theme between like the bands I've done is that it's been sort of effortless and cool, and I think that is more attractive to me as a songwriter and as a listener and fan of other bands than anything else. Right. You know,
I think maybe it just boils down to like whether it's some factors that are decided by a message board somewhere in 2001, or if it's just like whether or not someone's being authentic is probably the real answer of whether something feels fake or not.
Yeah. And like, you know, like sort of like anonymous or like community-based message board opinions never really bothered or affected me, because like anytime I would see these people or meet these people, they were just like, honestly, just like such like fucking losers that I was just like, what? Like, this is all right, whatever, who cares, you know?
Yeah. Okay, so you mentioned the band I wanted to ask you about. I guess my whole life, so I think my second ever hardcore show in my life was to see American Nightmare and Hope Conspiracy and Converge on the Jane Doe tour in Seattle, and it completely blew my mind.
Was that at the theater?
Yeah, the Paradox, I think.
Paradox, yeah.
Yeah, that was that. I must have been 15 or something.
Oh, that's rad!
Yeah,
I remember that show.
It was yeah. So cool. And so since then I followed you for a long time, and I was going to say too. That maybe, because what happened to Blink-182 is that they were called Blink, and then an Irish band sued them because they were also called Blink. So that's what they. So you guys should have just added a 182. You should have just been American Nightmare 182.
That's funny. I didn't know that. But we tried like just changing the name, you know, in like sort of short ways like that. But the band that claimed to have a trademark on it was just so crazy and adamant about. Like anytime, like, first of all, this idiot in our band hired an idiot lawyer who didn't handle it well. So that was like the first mistake. And basically we just let this band who claimed to have a trademark just walk all over us because we were young and didn't know. And the lawyer was a moron, you know? So it was like, it just didn't go well. Like, we tried to change our name to just AN and then American Nothing. And every time, supposedly the story is, the band would say, we're going to sue for confusion in the marketplace, which is crazy. There was no marketplace.
Were they, weren't they a cover band or something too?
They were, they started as a cover band. I think they made some, like, I don't know, whatever. They don't, they don't exist. They hardly existed ever. Right. You know, I remember like the story that we heard was that they were a Misfits cover band. And then, I remember like when American Nightmare played Hellfest outside of Syracuse, I was with, I was on the back of Hatebreed's bus with Jamie, Harley Flanagan, and Jerry Only, and we were all smoking a blunt together, and Jamie had this idea to get Jerry Only riled up about me getting sued because of this band. So he made it a point to call the band and tell them that it was bullshit and like, fuck you, how dare you cover my songs and sue this other band, like who the fuck are you, who cares, you know, like let him go. And I think it just made the other band even more upset, you know.
Oh my god, that's amazing.
It sucks. I had this like picture forever. I don't know where it is, but I'm just like, I'm probably like 22 and just my eyes are just like bleeding and I'm sitting in between Jerry Only and Harley that Jamie took, and I don't have anymore, but
that's so good. So that was, I mean, that's one of the kind of like rumor mill things that you would always hear, these kind of half threads of stories, or maybe that it was all true. I don't really know. But the other thing I've always heard, and I don't know how much you're allowed to talk about this or not, but I heard something about Fall Out Boy allegedly lifting your lyrics for their big breakthrough album, and then there was some sort of settlement or something. I mean, I don't really know. I would love to just hear anything that we can hear from you to confirm or deny if this actually happened, that they lifted your lyrics.
Well, I would say that was a weird time because, you know, American Nightmare doesn't seem like, in the grand scheme of things, that popular of a band, but it was a force in those few years, and it did kind of trickle into, I guess, pop punk territory, because, you know, like Blink-182 had their Atticus clothing company that sponsored and promoted us. We were supposed to tour with AFI, but that was canceled because of 9/11.
I feel like I also heard that Fall Out Boy had connections to like FSU or something early on.
That's not true, but
okay.
There was like, so whatever, we were supposed to play with AFI, that didn't happen. We took My Chemical Romance on their first tour ever. And then, so like we weren't like disassociated from that scene. And also Fall Out Boy, people in the band came from hardcore. Like I remember some of them from the first times we'd gone to Chicago. I remember some of them from just going on road trips to Chicago with friends' bands prior to AN. Like there were definitely people who were around. There was like a thing that happened that there's not much I can say about, but I can say that like the record that came out after the one you mentioned, I did co-write some songs with them and was like hired to do so. And that was like a mutual happy, cool thing, you know, but like, that's all I can really say about it, you know?
Okay. Well, I mean, that's something.
Yeah. So I think, I don't remember the name of the record, but the one after the one you mentioned, I think I co-wrote two or three songs on, I can't remember.
So you were like properly credited though on that one.
On that one, yes.
Okay, I got you. Okay, well, I guess the final thing I want to ask you just about this hilarious time and kind of the explosion of it is, did you see the recent photo of Ben Affleck wearing a Bridge 9 shirt?
No. That's a real thing?
There's like a paparazzi photo of Ben Affleck with his new girlfriend wearing a Bridge 9 photo, and it went viral like last week.
That makes sense. Boston, you know? that makes sense.
So Wes, thank you so much. What are you working on now? Like what's next from you?
Oh, I was also going to say to you that, something I forgot, but just remembered, is that Mark Hoppus and I shared a personal trainer a couple years ago. So I would be sitting on a couch as he was coming off, and he'd sit down and we'd talk for a few minutes, then we'd changed trainers. And aside from that, I think that's my only other connection.
That's a really good connection. That's really good. What did you talk about in those brief moments? Like cardio and stuff or?
No, like it was like a setup where my trainer asked me like the time before if I knew him. And I was like, no, but like he had this, whatever, had this company that like helped out my old band and et cetera. So he like set us up. He's like, you guys must know it, you know? And so it just became this thing that happened like two or three times where I think his wife was also training at the same gym at the same time. And he would be finished before her. And we would just be sitting on a couch together for a couple minutes, you know? But that's sort of a, that's my only other fun fact about Blink-182.
That's really good though.
Yeah.
And all, well, I mean, look, I know you've talked about this a million times before, but it, the new game is that today you're like friends with Tony Hawk too, right?
Yeah.
So you're just like, even though it was never your thing, you're kind of just like the skate punk and pop punk people still kind of find you.
I mean, it's not like not my thing either. Like first of all, Tony is a secret goth. That's his main thing. But I grew up skateboarding and listening to a lot of that music. And it's not, you know, I just happen to be more attracted to the angrier or darker side of like that music as opposed to the goofier side, you know?
Fair enough. Okay. Well, what are you working on now? I mean, you got anything you want to tell us about?
Yeah, I just sent a print. I have a publishing company called Heartworm Press, and we just finished the first issue of the Heartworm Reader, which is an annual literary magazine. The first issue has really interesting, amazing people like Alan Vega from Suicide, the late Alan Vega, has the late Genesis PRH from Throbbing Gristle and Psycho TV, B.B. Hansen, just 25 writers in it, which is a huge undertaking to work with that many people to get the right amount of poems from them each. That will be out, I think, October 1st. There's a new Cold Cave EP that's being mastered right now. American Nightmare is in the new Tony Hawk game that comes out today. What else? Had like hundreds of shows canceled, and we're just taking our time and been avoiding live stream offers because I'm not really into them, and it seems like a bit, I don't know, there's too many.
It's kind of weird.
I don't like doing things that you're supposed to do. So like anytime there's pressure that you're supposed to do this or say this, or if you don't do this, you're a bad person, or if you don't do this tour, no one's going to care about you. And that's the sort of stuff you hear the entire time you're in a band, you know?
Right.
And anytime people try to force me to do something, I naturally repel. And for better or for worse in terms of career or success or words like that. But it's kept me sane and kept me not really, there's only a few things I've ever done that I regret doing or second guess. And mostly those have fallen under the radar.
This podcast.
No.
All right.
Yeah. This podcast was fine. Just delete it and it's all good.
Okay, cool.
We're in a time crunch right now. That's not enough time.